Season 2 Primetime College Football is broadcast in high definition, presented by Pioneer Plasma. As we welcome you to Cincinnati, it's always been a Bengals town, but tonight it's a Bearcats town. The Big East season opens for Pittsburgh and Cincinnati. Dave Wannstedt wants his team contending for national championships again, and he has a senior leader in quarterback Tyler Palko. But Cincinnati, a very young football team for Mark D'Antonio. If they win tonight, what a boost it would provide to their program. Hi, everyone, and welcome to Cincinnati. I'm Bob Wischusen. I'll be joined coming up in a moment by Rod Gilmore, Trevor Maddich, and Rob Simulcare. Now, a big injury note for tonight for Pitt. Larod Stevens Howling, their workhorse in their win, at least of the first half, over Virginia. He did not make the trip. An injured ankle has him home in the Steel City. There are two freshmen that will back up for the Panthers at tailback. That means there will be a lot of pressure on their senior quarterback. And with more on that, let's head down to the field now and check in with Rod Gilmore.
But losing your top running back will put a lot more pressure on your passing game, and Tyler Palko, the senior quarterback, is aware of that. Now, he's talented, but he is also very emotional, and with a young team around him, he'll have to control those emotions. The word of the week for him is poise, and if he keeps his poise, then the Pitt offense will have a chance to be good tonight.
Well, Rod, if Pitt has senior leadership in Palko, Cincinnati has just the opposite going on. They don't know which of two quarterbacks to even start, and so they'll play both of them. Last year's starter, number 4, Dustin Grutza. The junior college All-American, number 9, Nick Davila. Both of them have prepared well and performed well in training camp and in the opening game. And so since neither has ascended, Cincinnati will play both. Now, is that good for this team? Well, we're going to find out, because these are not a thunder and lightning combination. Both of them are the same drop-back passer kind of player. So we'll find out if this kind of dual quarterback usage will be good for this team tonight.
Well, Trevor, a quarterback controversy that carries over into the season for Cincinnati. Dave Wannstedt, however, has national championship aspirations down the road for his program. He'll talk with Rob Simulcare when we return. The kickoff coming up as well.
Ooh, what's the never-ending pasta bowl?
Oh, just pick as many sauce and pasta combinations as you want. We'll keep him coming.
Now that would bring him endless happiness.
It's Olive Garden's never-ending pasta bowl with great sauces like new spinach Alfredo and our 5 cheese marinara. Pick any combination of sauce and pasta, then another. Try them all for just $7.95, plus endless breadsticks and salad.
Maybe we could try endless allowance at home.
Olive Garden, when you're here, you're family.
Cincinnati just about set for kickoff between the Bearcats and the Pitt Panthers. And again for Pitt, an injury situation that will certainly impact their offense tonight. Larod Stevens Howling, only a sophomore, but he played like a senior last week against Virginia. He had 19 touches in the first half, ran for 58 yards, also brought back a couple of kicks for 31 yards, had 37 yards in receiving yardage. Accounted, even though he only played for a half, for about a quarter of the overall offensive output for Pitt. He is out tonight, and that will certainly impact their chances. Dave Wannstedt is on the field alongside our Rob Simulcare. Rob?
All right, Coach, you enter this game without your top running back from last year, lost to an ankle injury. How does your offense overcome that tonight?
Well, you know, we have a couple running backs, obviously, that we feel good about giving the football to. I mean, it's not going to change our philosophy. I mean, we've been talking about being balanced since I got here, and we've got to find a way to run the ball. And the young guys that get in there, we're going to play a couple freshmen. They got to pick up the slack, and offensive line's got to block them. And, you know, we got to make sure that we don't turn this into a one-sided game.
Meanwhile, for you personally, this is your second year back in the college game after a long career in the NFL. What kind of adjustments are you making this year to the way you've coached as opposed to last year?
Oh, I think the biggest adjustment is just the whole time management thing. You know, we've got so much better feel for the strengths and weaknesses, what our players can do and the amount of time that we have with them and what we can't do, and you make sure you spend your time on the things that are important.
All right, Coach, thanks a lot.
All right, Rod, thanks very much. Rod, you know, Dave Wannstedt is not setting any type of limits or any type of ceiling on what he thinks the Pitt program can become once again.
Well, I think he's finding out that he's getting adjusted to the college game. He knows this team better than he knew last year's team, and the time management thing, that was huge. Going from the NFL to only 20 hours a week with your young team, that was an adjustment for him.
It was, but what's not an adjustment is his attitude. He's trying to bring back the Pitt tradition, the Pitt mystique, and he's the perfect man for that job, being a Pitt grad, played here for the Panthers, and he knows how to talk to the recruits and the recruits' parents in Pennsylvania and Ohio.
Although, Trevor, when you think about the difference between coaching in the NFL and coaching in college, or let's say coaching at Ohio State and coaching here in Cincinnati, that's the challenge for Mark D'Antonio. He won a national championship as a defensive coordinator under Jim Tressel with the Buckeyes.
And he wants to take this program to the BCS. He believes that he can do it, and he talks to his team even now about winning a conference championship and playing in the BCS.
Wrestle set to kick off. Goodman and Moore back deep to receive, and we are underway. And misjudging it is Goodman, so it will be a touchback for the Cincinnati offense. And the Cincinnati offensive line, Trevor Maddich, is certainly under the gun this season. This group last year allowed 40 sacks. That was last in the Big East.
And that's good that they've got two quarterbacks, because that's only 20 per. They think they'll be a lot better now, though.
Well, their starting quarterback, at least for the start of tonight's game, is Dustin Grutza, but we will certainly see Nick Davila at some point. They may alternate quarters depending on how Grutza comes out and plays. It might alter the way D'Antonio uses his two-headed quarterback, but it will be interesting to see the breakup in playing time between them both. On first down, though, to the ground. Butler Benton picks up a yard. And since we have the two quarterbacks to talk about, I guess, Trevor, we list them both as impact players, although Brent Celek, no matter who's on the field, will be their number one target.
Well, Bob, Celek will be a critical part for these quarterbacks because he needs to get open quickly and often so they can dump the ball and not take those hits.
Second down and eight, just underway here in the first quarter. Again, Grutza, who played most of last year, got hit a lot and was hurt a lot. His offensive line protected him rather well last week against Eastern Kentucky. And on second down, he finds Celek for a modest gain. Gang tackle. And Rod, let's check the Pitt defense. And this is a defense that has gone through many position changes in an effort to try and create a speed factor. Gus Moustakas, Doug Fulmer, Clint Session, Tommy Campbell, all changing positions.
Now that's a new thing here at Pitt, but it's old school for Wannstedt. He did it at Miami. He did it at the University of Miami, and he did it at the Dallas Cowboys. Get your fastest players on the field, and that's why they made the position switches.
Flag down. So the Bearcats break the huddle with 12 players. That cost them 5 yards.
Wannstedt is a master at taking, for example, a defensive back and putting some muscle on him and taking that speedy defensive back and turning him into a linebacker and doing the same thing with the linebacker, turning him into a defensive lineman.
Well, this fast position-changed Pitt defense now has Cincinnati on the game's opening possession in third down and 10, and it's a shotgun set for Grutza. The blitz comes from the corner. Grutza eludes the pressure and throws it way over the head of Ernest Jackson, incomplete. So Pittsburgh forces Cincinnati 3 downs and out.
I think on that opening series, you got a sense of the increased speed of the Pitt defense. Cincinnati tried to go wide a couple times, nothing doing. They got blitzed, pushed the quarterback out of the pocket.
And part of that speed is two forced mistakes from the quarterback. Dave Wannstedt was telling us that a faster defensive group puts extra pressure on the quarterback, and he expects that to lead to mistakes and therefore big plays.
Brian Steele is set to punt. Darrell Revis back deep to receive, and it's a nice spiraling kick, forcing Revis up against the sideline, and he fumbles the football. Forced to retreat to his own 15-yard line, and now he has nowhere to go. So a special teams mistake made by an All-American cornerback who will certainly be playing on Sundays next year, and that costs Pitt field position in a big way.
Well, you're talking about a guy who's not a rookie. In fact, he took a punt back for a touchdown against Cincinnati last year, about 79 yards, and he's probably thinking about doing that here. He just misjudged the ball, and then he had no choice but to be careful after that.
Last season, Cincinnati felt as if they lost the game on special teams. They allowed two special teams returns for touchdowns against Pitt. Shane Brooks on first down, gets to the sideline, and comes together with Haruki Nakamura as we check the Pittsburgh offense. And this offensive group for Pitt, a lot of youth around Tyler Palco. Shane Brooks, Oderic Turner, Conridge Collins, all freshmen, and Jeff Ota is a JUCO transfer, a first-time starter this year.
Yeah, and as a first-time starter, his youth showed up last week against Virginia, two holding penalties in that ball game that affected their drives. A lot of youth on the field for the Pitt offense.
Palco a moment ahead of the sideline as John Simonitis, the starting right guard, looks as if he tweaked his right knee. So certainly the focal point now, Rod, is Tyler Palco. He's been second team All Big East the last 2 years in a row. And as a fifth year senior, they really feel as if he has matured, especially the way he approaches the game emotionally.
Well, I think that's right. But you have to remember, you're talking about a guy who was the most successful high school quarterback in the history of Pennsylvania high school football. And he was outstanding. And last year he suffered through his first losing season ever, and he's an emotional guy, and it was frustrating for him, and now he's learning how to be calmer and not show those emotions, especially around a young team.
On second and five, an end around to TJ Porter, and it looks to be good enough for a first down. A gain of six. Trevor Anderson made the stop. As we take a look at what it has been like for the Pitt Panthers over the last 6 years. 5-6 last year in the first season for Dave Wanstead.
Yeah, and you go back to seeing what it was there for him. 7-5 back in 2000, another 7-5. Winning. And that's exactly what Palco did, you know, throughout his career. So you can understand how he was frustrated last season.
On first and 10. From the 26, Palco back to throw. Here comes the blitz. He's under pressure. Somehow escapes the rush and flings it to the near side. Cincinnati thought they had him. Mike Nickens came on a corner blitz.
And I can guarantee you, Matt Cavanaugh, the offensive coordinator, was wincing over there on the sideline when that ball came out of Palco's hand.
Well, this is what he has done in the past when he's been the bad Palco. He has pressed. Now, right now, he's under pressure, and he tries to throw the ball. That should very well have been picked off and thrown and run back for a touchdown. But why that's not intentional grounding, I'm not sure.
Second down and 10. Big pressure brought by Mark D'Antonio on first down. Palco again to throw, this time only a four-man rush. Over the middle finds his freshman fullback, or sophomore fullback rather, in Conridge Collins. As we take a look now at the Cincinnati defense, and Trevor Maddich with Anthony Hogue, Terrell Byrd, Tony Carvetti, and Trevor Anderson up front. It's a very small but active defensive line.
It is. Tony Carvetti listed at 6 feet 235. Dave Wanstead wants to establish a smash mouth mentality. He says, look, there's Lilliputians up front. Let's go smash him in the mouth.
Third down and two, a chance for the Bearcats to hold defensively. Here comes the blitz again. Palco to the near side. Intended for Oderic Turner. He was tied up with Mickens. Turner was looking for a flag. It will be fourth down.
All right, this is what you talked about. Palco now is at a turning point in this game already. You can see, talking to the coach, he's saying, look, I did the right thing. Did I not do the right thing? It doesn't matter. What matters is his emotion, that he not get overly emotional now, that he keep his cool, because then the good Palco can ascend over the evil Palco.
Are you saying he's got a split personality?
Absolutely.
Gressel gets it away. Derek Stewart from his own 14. It's returnable. And he's tripped up at the 28-yard line. Special teams tackle made by Scott McKillop. 53-yard punt, a 14-yard return. The Bearcats back to the offense next.
Lived my whole life on the Gulf Coast, but when Katrina hit, I ended up in Massapequa, New York.
Roseville, Michigan.
Dyersburg, Tennessee.
We ended up in Aniana, Alabama. They chartered a bus and drove 300 miles to get us out of there. They told us we weren't going to be comfortable till y'all get comfortable. Turns out Tom's not with the bus company. He's with State Farm.
Just lost everything. Honestly, thank God for Anita. She asked me what I did for a living and found me a job.
Without Cheryl, we would have been on the street.
That money helped me to be strong for my children.
And I really thank State Farm for that.
Mike made 4 round trips from Oregon to Mississippi to bring us beds and supplies.
All across the country, State Farm agents have helped.
And every day, we continue to help those affected by Katrina.
People say New Orleans was the forgotten city, but I wasn't forgotten.
How would you thank somebody for saving your life and turning it back around again?
Time for something new from eBay.
eBay Express is the new place to find new items you can buy right away. From new... Hey!
Get it new. Buy it now. eBayExpress.com.
We advance in leaps and bounds, from generation to generation. At Acura, we help people advance. From where they are to where they could be.
Versus two. Buckeyes, Longhorns. So much at stake, so early in the season. 8 p.m. Eastern in prime time. ESPN on ABC. It's Ohio State and Texas on Saturday Night Football.
Back to the action. Greg Moore off tackle right for 2 yards for the Bearcats, and what a game that could potentially be tomorrow night.
You know, for so long, we didn't get non-conference matchups like that. And the last couple years, we've gotten back to getting those types of games. I think it's going to be just an outrageously fantastic game. Look how long it's been since you've seen a number one and number two in a regular season game.
I think that's one of the reasons everybody's so excited. It's not just a game, it's an event.
Second down and 8 with Dustin Grootzer. Going play action under some pressure, trying to set the screen up. And he can't make connection with Marcus Waugh. It will be third down.
You know, guys, being in the Cincinnati area, you know, the last week or so, if you will, because we were in Louisville last week, we've heard a lot about this game tomorrow night. I mean, players, coaches, fans, Joe on the street, everybody talks about the Ohio State game tomorrow night. I mean, that guy, he's got his Ohio State Cincinnati red on.
Well, Mark D'Antonio knows something about coaching in big games. Of course, he was the defensive coordinator alongside Jim Tressel. The screen this time works to Greg Moore, and he has a first down. The official on the far side slipped for a moment as he slipped on the sticks marker at the 38-yard line. It looked like he may have lost exactly where he wanted to spot the football, and that they may now have to measure. This will be very close to a first down. It looked as if Moore had it. But watch the official at the top of your screen.
Yeah, but a very smart play call by Don Treadwell, the offensive coordinator. Take advantage of that Pittsburgh speed, run screen passes. Let them run their speed out of their play.
Another thing that took advantage of the speed and to counter it, Greg Moore, of the 3 tailbacks who will play tonight for Cincinnati, is the fastest, and he's the home run hitter. Get the ball to him in space, you've got speed on speed.
It is a first down for Cincinnati. So the Bearcats move the chains at their own 38-yard line. Mark D'Antonio has tutored under some of the great college football minds. Jim Tressel, he was an assistant with Nick Saban for 5 years as well. Back to the ground attack, looking for some room is Butler Benton, and he picks up four.
Now, when you talk about speed, here's another way to counter it. Run the ball straight at it. The running backs of Cincinnati are pretty fast. Greg Moore is very fast. But Cincinnati will not beat Pitt sideline to sideline today, so don't even try on the running game. Run straight at it.
Second down and six. Three wide receivers and a shotgun for Grutza. Instead, it's an inside handoff. And with running room is Bradley Glattauer. Gets into Pitt territory inside the 40-yard line and knocked out at the Pitt 37. A junior from right here in Cincinnati, Bradley Glattauer.
Now watch if the guard, number 71, Linkenbach, pull to the right side. And then you get a nice cutback off of that by Glattauer. He had a little bit of speed for a big guy.
He went 10 yards into the center of that line before the first defender put a hand on him.
A 20-yard gain. Glattauer was Cincinnati's leading rusher last season. He averaged about 4.5 yards per carry. And now he is split out. Grutza spreads the field. Slant knocked away, flag comes out. Kennard Cox will be called for pass interference as he jumped over the top of Bill Polen.
Dustin Grutza's pass complete to Brad.
Automatic first down off the penalty is Kennard Cox, whose cousin Torrey Cox also went to Pitt and now plays for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
Well, Kennard Cox is going to get a workout tonight because he's got Revis on the other side, and Cincinnati wants to stay away from Revis.
Glattauer, the tailback. Again, we've already seen Butler Benton and Greg Moore. So not only will we see two different quarterbacks tonight for the Bearcats, we'll see three different tailbacks. Glattauer picked up 20 on his first carry and nothing doing here. Coming up to make the stop, Doug Fulmer. No gain. Let's take a look at the three running backs last year for Cincinnati, and they put up numbers that one real good running back would certainly put up collectively.
Well, one of the great things about having three interchangeable guys is that the competition in every play in practice and every play on the field will get the very, very best, so they get the match from their talent.
Second down and 11. You wonder why that same argument might not apply to having two quarterbacks, but usually it doesn't. Grutza to the outside, incomplete, a flag down. That flag thrown in the backfield, and it came out late. It will be holding against Cincinnati.
That's a very good point about the quarterbacks. Why wouldn't it be the same? And I think you'd have a good argument if you talked about a quarterback who's a drop-back passer and a second who's a scrambler. So there's a difference for the defense. But with Cincinnati, both are the same kind of guy. And I know the Arizona State situation with their quarterback controversy and their quarterback situation influenced this coaching staff. Influenced his coaching staff in not wanting to make a decision before they were sure.
Well, all positions are not created equal. I don't think you can do at the quarterback spot what you can do at the backup running back, backup wide receiver, backup left tackle. It's just not the same. You're talking about a leadership position. You're talking about a place that you need a lot of rhythm and confidence in.
Grutza now facing second down at 21. A four-man rush, and he will go down. The pocket collapses. It was Chris McKillop, who last year started every game and had 3.5 sacks, and he picks up his first this season.
Well, this is not a blitz. It's just a straight four-man rush, and you can see the relentlessness of this pass rush. One feature of a Dave Wannstedt defense is to have a defensive line that is disruptive on its own without the blitz.
I think that was on the quarterback. I don't think he should have stepped up that far in the pocket. I think he walked into that sack.
Third down and 22. Now for Cincinnati, they would take just getting into field goal position. Over the middle, a heavy hit laid at the 26-yard line on Bill Polen, but he holds onto the football. Oh, as he popped, it will be fourth down and two as Eric Thatcher. And this one worth looking at full speed.
Well, Eric Thatcher is sitting in the middle just waiting. Listen.
Oh, wow. Look at the chin strap up around his nose.
On fourth down and a long two, though, fourth down and three as Poland shaken up.
That's why you like to have that ball thrown low if you throw it over the middle.
Kevin Lovell on to attempt a 42-yard field goal as D'Antonio goes for the points. It's a fake, and they won't get it. Brian Steele, the holder, jumped up, but Darrell Revis tracked him down.
Is there any wonder why that guy is an All-American corner? I mean, this is a great play. You have to be alert and then react. And look at him come with the speed from the far side. He was going so hard to try to block the kick that he just continued right on to snuff out the fake kick.
So Cincinnati, the failed fake field goal attempt. They turn it over on downs. Darrell Revis makes another All-American play.
Acura RDX with super handling all-wheel drive. The all-new Acura RDX with real-time traffic.
Well, it's been a long day for Strahan.
What a lovely shot!
Yeah! Hey, maybe it's your deodorant. Let's start over. No, this time start with new Right Guard Sport Deodorant, now packed with even more scent. Right Guard, start right and right.
Your ultimate drink stop. Drive in for Sonic's new Peach Fruit Smoothie. A delicious, fat-free combination of real peaches and creamy yogurt blended to perfection. Sonic's new Peach Fruit Smoothie. It's not just good, it's Sonic good.
Spending limit? Who cares?
Not us, cause them ain't no credit cards.
Sure ain't.
Them motorcycles was expensive and fast.
And loud.
Oh, yeah. Them bikes be like, wah.
No, like,
they went like, wah. Sound good, cause they free. Shoot.
Yeah, shoot.
City Identity Theft Solutions. Talk to a real person to help get your life back. Free when you get a Citi credit card or Citibank account.
You've always been competitive. That's why you choose GNC's Mega Men Sport Multivitamin. It's balanced nutrition and energy support for optimal health and athletic performance. Plus, it's enhanced with antioxidants, prostate, and heart support. At GNC, we believe a quality life starts from within. Live well.
Germs in your mouth. The problem is, they keep coming back. You need a toothpaste that keeps on fighting. Colgate Total, the only toothpaste clinically proven to fight germs for a full 12 hours.
ESPN2's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Acura and Right Guard. Get the power strike from Right Guard. Right Guard, right to the end of the day.
It's been a beautiful night already here in Cincinnati. The Cincinnati Bearcats, who Mark D'Antonio wants to reestablish as a program of football prominence. It's certainly a big basketball school, but right now they are in a scoreless tie with Pitt. With under 6 minutes to go in the first quarter, Tyler Palko and Pitt back to the offense. And it's the true freshman, Kevin Collier, for a couple of yards. But a big special teams play made a moment ago by the Panthers.
Let's go back to the fake field goal. There's Revis. Watch him come around. This is such a great play because of the hustle involved. Look at this. He doesn't take this play off. He goes full out to try and block the kick. And when it becomes a fake, he's in great position to make a play.
And that turns it back over on downs to Pitt. Second down and nine after Collier picked up one on first down. Derek Kinder has been quiet at the start. He's the motion man. Palko, play action. Looking up top for his tight end, Darryl Strong. Palko now 1-for-4 with three incompletions as we check in with Rob Simulcare on the sideline.
And Bob, we've talked about Palko and his need to be a leader, and that's something that the coaches here at Pitt have talked about an awful lot. After that last series, when he was nearly sacked, almost threw the ball away, came over to the sideline, and he was very composed, walked right up to those wide receivers, this young wide receiver corps they've got, and talked to them about the routes they were running, trying to get that offense on track. So that leadership quality they're looking for out of Palko, so far he looks cool under pressure.
And that's something that's been a bit different for Tyler Palko, as Rob pointed out, not only cool under pressure and composed, but also Matt Kavanaugh, the offensive coordinator, who of course was the starting quarterback for the 1976 Pitt National Championship team, told us that the big adjustment that Palko needed to make, guys, was not showing outwardly a lot of emotion and a lot of frustration when things would go wrong. He thought that rubbed off in a negative way on his teammates.
Well, and he showed him Joe Cool. I mean, he said, you know, you need to be more like guys like Joe Montana, Steve Young. And he knows those guys. He played with those guys, Matt Kavanaugh did. So he pulled out the tape, let him look at those guys, and then ask him to take a look at some of the guys that he himself liked, Palko. And I bet one of those guys is Matt Leinart, who was a real cool guy at USC.
Third down and nine. Five-man front for the Bearcats as they show blitz. Haruki Nakamura at the top of your screen, cheating in. Instead, he drops back. Only a four-man rush. Flags down, incomplete. And the play blown dead at the line. Whistles were blowing just as the snap occurred.
False start. Number 84 on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Remains third down.
Roger, you talked about Tyler Palko being shown Joe Cool, Joe Montana, and others. And the key for Matt Kavanaugh there was to explain to Tyler Palko that you can be imperfect and still do well. You can make mistakes, but still be excellent if you manage the game well.
And Matt Kavanaugh certainly understands that. I mean, he was a pretty good quarterback in his own right. MVP of the 1976 National Championship team. Played in the NFL for a long time and has a lot to teach Tyler Palko.
We asked some of the Pitt players, and actually Matt Kavanaugh, what he had to teach them in terms of looking at a former National Championship quarterback. He laughed. He said, these guys weren't even born when we won the National Championship. Sneaking inside, Shane Brooks is brought down. That's a pretty play by the Cincinnati defensive front to collapse things. And Kevin McCullough brought him down.
Now, this undersized line is doing a good job of twisting and stunting to make sure they cover the correct lanes and put pressure inside. That draw play didn't go anywhere. It didn't fool them at all.
Derek Stewart back deep to receive. Fair catch called for. He bobbles it as there was traffic in the vicinity, but holds on at the 30-yard line. Again, we are in Ohio here tonight in Cincinnati, but there happens to be, I'm not sure if you guys are aware, another football game that involves an Ohio team. It happens tomorrow night, Saturday Night Football in primetime on ABC at 8 p.m. Number one against number two, Ohio State and Texas. Jim Tressel and Mack Brown bring, and I heard you guys talking before the game on ESPN News tonight, an interesting debate about how you think it might come down to a quarterback battle. An experienced quarterback for Ohio State and an inexperienced quarterback, obviously, for Texas.
I'm not ignoring you. I just want to see this play.
Dustin Grootza. Play action. He has some room to the near side. Wide open at the 35 is Dominic Goodwin. And picks up 9 yards after the catch for a gain of 14 overall. And the players actually from Cincinnati even weighed in on what they're hoping to see tomorrow night.
I'd have to say I'm going for Ohio State on this one. You know, just because, you know, hopefully they're undefeated when we go up there.
It'd be good to see, you know, Alex Boone, Ted Ginn, and guys like Troy Smith to be successful against a team like Texas. You know, Texas is a very high-powered team.
I'm going to have some popcorn. I'm going to be sitting with my girls and my wife, and we'll be watching as a fan.
Well, certainly a big fan of Ohio State. Now in the backfield, no chance on that end around. Derek Stewart brought down by Tommy Campbell. And again, Campbell, the converted strong safety, now playing weak side linebacker, and he was brought to that position for speed reasons.
Well, Campbell runs a 4.440. If you look at the right of your screen, you're going to see him come around. The two outside linebackers that got most of the playing time last year ran a 5.040. Campbell at 4.4. Much, much more speed. Last year, that play would have gotten the corner.
A loss of 12, second and 22 now for the Bearcats at field position. Takes a major hit for Cincinnati as well, back all the way to their own 32-yard line. Running room, though, Butler Binton picks up a few out to the 39. Again, let's look at some of these speed guys that Pitt has on defense.
We talked about the concept. What you do is you take a guy who plays one position and beef him up and move him and use that speed. Clint Sessions from inside linebacker to outside. Tommy Campbell, defensive back. Put some strength on him, a little muscle, make him a linebacker. Doug Fulmer, Mostaskis, both of them down linemen now after being a linebacker and an outside end. Those guys can all run.
An athletic defensive front, and that's H.B. Blades. And what a dangerous inside linebacker he is on the preseason Butkus Award list. Brutza on third down, over the middle, finds the tight end Selleck, and he fights his way to the sticks. Oh, it looks to be a half yard shy. Sam Bryant and H.B. Blades back in coverage combined on the stop. Brent Selleck, who was voted as an offensive captain by his teammates. It's fourth down and a half yard.
You know, all that speed is great, but it doesn't do you much good if you don't play your zones correctly. You can let receivers get through there and almost pick up a first down.
A big early decision on the Cincinnati sideline. They are opting to punt. This is the right move, is it not?
The offense stayed out there, and then the punt team now has just run on. I think it is the right decision. 0-0, play the field position game.
Steal again to punt, and again Revis is back deep to receive. Again calls for a fair catch, and Fields at the 15-yard line. With 1:13 remaining in a scoreless first quarter. We haven't had points, but we've had some big plays. And we'll return to Cincinnati in a moment.
We're at the Great American Beer Fest in Denver.
This is where all the great brewers bring the best beer.
Cheers.
We had 2,300 entries into the beer competition.
If you have a medal from the GABF as a brewer, that's as good as it gets.
We just try to make the best beer that we can make, and if we get the awards, great.
And the gold to Sam Adams Light, Samuel Adams Pale Ale, Samuel Adams Double Bomb, Samuel Adams Millennium.
Friday, it's casual day, so hopefully you're taking full advantage. It's also the fifth day of a seven-day week. 7 + 5 = 12, which of course is the retired number of Jim Kelly and Joe Namath. It also happens to be Heinz Ward's favorite movie. And if that's not enough, there's only 3 days till a doubleheader on Monday night. 3 days till the Vikings face the Redskins at 7 o'clock, and the Chargers take on the Raiders at 10:15. TGIAM, people. Thank God it's almost Monday.
Okay, huddle up. Pate, take the mulch. Dan, grab a rake. I'll bring the bags and the petunias. Ready?
It's movie time, boys.
Eli, you go popcorn. Butter, no salt.
Peyton, you dim the lights. Not too dark, not too bright.
I got dibs on the recliner.
Ready?
Eggs, skillet, spatula. Ready?
Check it to pancakes. Pancakes!
For Reebok NFL gear, you gotta go to Moe's.
Now until September 17th, it's the New York Long Island Honda Dealers Now You See Them, Now You Don't sales event. Stop by or go to nylihonda.com.
The Big East opener for Pitt and Cincinnati. Both of these teams won their opening games last week. Cincinnati over a 1AA opponent in Eastern Kentucky, but Pitt beat up on the University of Virginia. Al Groh came to Heinz Field, and Dave Wannstedt's team handed it to the Cavaliers. Although they are in a very tough battle here in the first quarter with Cincinnati. Tyler Palco looking downfield. Finds his tight end up the left sideline. And that's Steve Bukas, a first down to the 30-yard line.
Well, Cincinnati likes to play a lot of press coverage. Watch the tight end here. He's going to get a little help. There's going to be a rub off. His wide receiver is going to come in and block off his man, and that's going to allow the tight end to get outside. Lucius is out there to catch the ball. That's not fair. Shouldn't have a wide receiver knocking off a defensive back.
Hey, don't play defensive back.
Last year, Bukas had 17 catches, two touchdowns. 17 catches, a career high. And here comes the freshman, Shane Brooks, picking up six. Took a hit from Nakamura and Ross, the two safeties. It'll be second down and short.
You know, Trevor, this Cincinnati defense, they like to play their corners right up in the face of the wide receivers, that press coverage. Now, they don't always play man. They'll come off and play zone from that, but that takes away the quick, short passing game that Pittsburgh kind of likes to do off a three-step quarterback drop.
And with young receivers out there, it might be interesting if Palco will force it in.
Palco with three receivers, an offensive coordinator's play-calling dream, second and three. Instead, they throw the wide receiver hitch, and that will be good for a first down to T.J. Porter. And that will take us most likely to the end of the first quarter.
Well, this time you see that they had two receivers out there, one cornerback, and they could not do the press coverage, so it was easy to do the screen out there since there was nobody covering the inside receiver.
One quarter in the books, no score on the scoreboard. A very tough battle. The River City rivalry so far deadlocked.
The best golf in the world, the 2006 PGA Tour on ESPN. With you and the road. The all-new turbocharged Acura RDX with super handling all-wheel drive. Acura. Advance.
Your destination is approaching. Prepare to turn right.
Part MP3 player, part navigation system, the sweetest phone around. Everybody loves chocolate by LG, exclusively from Verizon Wireless.
Get the front seat
because I have the higher education.
What do you
I
mean?
Took honors classes.
In high school.
Hey, it's Bobby Bowden.
I'm gonna touch him.
Now would be a good time to have accident forgiveness.
I'm still gonna touch him.
Part of Allstate, your choice auto insurance. Are you in good hands?
That wasn't him.
But you still touched him.
Pitt's defense holds Cincinnati scoreless in the first quarter, but equally impressive, maybe more so, the 11 on the field right now for the Bearcats holding Pitt scoreless in the first quarter. Pitt's first eight plays totaled 17 yards. Their last three have been good for 27, and they now have it first and 10. Again to the ground, again, it's one of the freshmen. To the near side comes Brooks, and he may have picked up a half yard. Leo Morgan and Terrell Byrd came up to make the stop.
You know, they really do miss Stevens Howling at the running back spot, a guy who can run the screen passes, can run the ball and draws. He's very quick. They lose his quickness. They pick up some power, a guy who can make contact and get yardage in Brooks, but that quickness could make one guy miss. They're missing that in the lineup right now.
Second down and 10. Palco bootlegs to the near side. And a controlled pass caught by Marcel Pestano for 5 yards.
You talk about Stevens Howling, a running back for Pitt. Didn't make the trip. Sprained an ankle last week against Virginia, and it was really a Wednesday decision as to whether or not he would be able to play. Palco managing this offense, not doing anything spectacular, not trying to do anything spectacular, and that's what they've watched from him.
I'll tell you one thing. He threw a couple of spectacular balls last week against Virginia, 70-yard-plus touchdown passes.
And so far, Pitt 0 for 2 on third down. This is their third down conversion attempt of the night, third and 5. And Palco calls timeout. Well, you have to love the start if you're the Cincinnati defense of Pat Narduzzi, their defensive coordinator. And right now, Tyler Palco, it's kind of a sputtering attack for the Panthers, and he seems a bit confused.
Well, I think Narduzzi's done a great job of mixing things up. He's brought pressure from the field. He's brought it from the short field. He's used different people, and he's stunted his defensive linemen. Twists here and there, enough to make Palco and to make Kavanaugh, the offensive coordinator, think about it. Here you see the defensive coordinator right up there. That's Pat Narduzzi right there. Well, he's an excitable guy, isn't he?
We had a fun time talking to him yesterday.
You can talk with a coach for a minute and a half and tell if you would play for this guy. Now, you don't know if he's good yet, but you know from a man-to-man standpoint, if you'd play for this guy, and Narduzzi is a guy that anybody would want to play for.
He does good stuff with his guys. He pushes them hard, too, you know, and they like it. He's right out there, enthusiastic. He's not a coach you have to lean in to hear. He gets your attention pretty quickly.
And you know what? He has fun in the wintertime to develop conditioning and toughness amongst his players. There was snow all over this field. He had them wrestle on the field, wrestle. No takedowns. They started down, but they were grappling in the ice.
Yeah, that sounds like a lot of fun.
Well,
I'm sure he had fun watching.
Have you tried it?
I don't know if I need to try that to know it's not that much fun. Palco, quarterback draw, puts it on the ground. Cincinnati football. The first big turnover and one of the first big moments goes to the Bearcats. Anthony Williams knocked it free.
Well, as usual, this play will be reviewed since every play is reviewed in the replay booth. Did the ball come out because of the ground or did he lose it on contact? That's very close.
You know, Rod, that looks like he loses it when it hits the ground. Now watch the ball in his right arm. He never extends the ball.
It's being reviewed.
That's a fumble. That ball's wiggling free before he made contact with the ground.
He never tries to extend it. If it comes out, it's because of the hit. Oh, it does come out.
That's a good call,
Bob.
Good call on the field.
Well, the officials right now are reviewing it, and Trevor Anderson came up with the recovery.
Yeah, on that replay, you could clearly see ball was out while Palco was in the air. Before his knee came down to touch the ground, that ball came out. It was a good call.
Now, that's Dennis Hennigan, the referee. Explain to the folks at home who may not be familiar, guys, with the replay rules in college football, what he's being told right now.
Right now, he's being told what the replay official is seeing. He first tells the replay official what the call was on the field. And the line judge there is the one who made the call.
After review, the call on the field is confirmed. First down.
But he's not giving input, right, Trevor? I mean, basically, he's just listening to the replay booth. They make the decision. All he does is relay that decision to us.
The referee and the official who made the call will tell the replay official what they saw. And then the replay official will then say what he sees, and that will be the decision.
Well, the decision on the field confirmed, first and 10, and Dustin Grootsa is still in at quarterback. A couple of yards off the right side for Greg Moore. So last week it was first quarter, third quarter for Grootsa, second quarter, fourth quarter for Davila. Davila not in the game right now, though.
And I'm a little bit surprised about that. This may be nothing more than the head coach deciding that he wanted to give Grootsa a chance to run the offense in good field position.
He's got great field position now, second and 8 from midfield. Again, Grootsa, threw for 8,000 yards and 82 touchdowns at Mason County High in Kentucky. So he was a high school legend when he came here to Cincinnati, and he will throw, setting up the screen. Moore gets loose, and he has a first down to the Panthers' 41-yard line, tripped up by H.B. Blades.
Both of these quarterbacks performed well last week against Eastern Kentucky. And really, the coach has decided that he wants the players around them to see that if you work hard, if you produce, if you do what the coaches ask, you'll get a chance to play. And because they're so close, the coaches did not want the rest of the team to see a guy that deserved to play sit on the bench.
Nick Davila on the sideline waiting his turn, the junior college transfer. Right now, it's Grootsa, only a sophomore. He started every game last year as a redshirt freshman, and not much for the junior Greg Moore as he is stood up by Rashad Duncan.
You know, Trevor, I think D'Antonio was also influenced by the situation out at Arizona State, where the senior quarterback, Sam Keller, won the job about a week before the opening game, and then 2 days later, Rob Carpenter, who's a sophomore, was vaulted ahead of Keller to be the starting quarterback. Keller then transferred to Nebraska. And Antonio said he did not want to have anything like that happen here. He wanted it to be fair and open and give both guys a chance.
Bradley Glattauer back in at tailback, and he gets popped at the line. Again coming through is Rashad Duncan. It's third down and long.
And Rod, in giving them a chance, it'll play out itself. I mean, one of the two may rise up and definitely be the one that should get most of the playing time. As it is right now, Grootsa is managing this offense well. They don't have any points, but he's taking what the defense is giving, which isn't much, and he's not making mistakes.
Third down and nine. A spread formation out of the shotgun for Grootsa. It's a four-man rush. Coming free on the blitz was H.B. Blades, and he forced Grootsa to unload quickly. He still paid the price and could not find Selleck, and now it's fourth and nine.
Now, it's fourth and nine. They're going to have to turn the ball over to Pitt. It's 0-0. However, look at the field position. The field position battle right now is being won by Cincinnati.
Great blitz call here. This is designed to force the quarterback to throw it quickly. Your defensive back settle in looking for a quick pass. You know you're going to be able to tackle a guy before he gets the first down.
And a mistake by that mistake-prone offensive line for Cincinnati. As the punt will be stopped at the one-yard line by the Bearcats. Brian Steele with beautiful touch at the two-yard line. It will be Tyler Palco's football, still scoreless here in the first half.
Pressure, enemy of engines. Pennzoil Platinum. It's the full synthetic with adaptive molecules that continually join forces to help conquer the enormous pressure inside your engine. Not just oil, Pennzoil.
We've come to the birthplace of gridlock with two cars and one goal. Get off the island first. Horsepower Lexus GS 350. You can't lose.
That's me, Evelyn, and it's my seventh day with Prilosec OTC. It started to work on my frequent heartburn on day one. Zero heartburn for 24 hours with one pill a day. So what day are you on?
Bam here, gonna show you how Right Guard Extreme Power Stripe works. This team represents odor. This team represents the power stripe. Only Right Guard Extreme has the power stripe. It drops odor like a bad habit.
Extreme! Get Right Guard!
Need new tires? Get
to the big Bridgestone rebate event for up to a $100 mail-in rebate on select Bridgestone Dueler tires, September 7th through October 7th. Only at your local participating Bridgestone and Firestone retailer. Wherever you see this Bridgestone sign.
ESPN2's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Lexus and the new 303-horsepower GS350 and KFC's fiery buffalo boneless wings. It's no bones, all flavor, only at KFC.
Bob Wischusen, Trevor Maddich, Rod Gilmore, Rob Simulcare here in Cincinnati as Pitt starts at their own 2-yard line. We are still scoreless. And Trevor, you talked about how important field position is. Well, you couldn't have worse field position. If you're the Pitt Panthers, they have averaged their starting drives at their own 14-yard line. And they go to the fullback on first down for 2 yards, so it doesn't get much better.
No, and this kind of a football game is really shaped up as an old-fashioned smash mouth, let the other team make a mistake for you to win the game kind of thing. And that's what Dave Wannstedt and Mark D'Antonio are, old-style coaches. And so you don't see points, but you see a defensive battle with field position being the key, and Cincinnati is winning that right now.
Brooks dots the I. Second down and 8, a gain of only 2 on first down. The Cincinnati crowd in Palco's ear. Again, the freshman hurdles out to about the 4. Coming up was Corey Smith to force action, and Smith back in action after missing last week with a hamstring injury. He's probably their best all-around tackler.
Take a look at Terrell Byrd. He is 6'1", listed at 285. They're lying on both. He's much smaller than that, and yet he still stood up against a guy that outweighs him by about 40 pounds and stuffed the middle of that line.
Yeah, what did he tell us yesterday? That he had his tonsils out before training camp, and so he lost about 10 or 12 pounds. He's only about 270 or so inside there going against a 300-pounder.
Third down and 8. Palco from the end zone swings it to Collins. He has the first down. The sophomore fullback Conridge Collins gets out across the 15-yard line.
Very nice pass play. They flooded that area with 3 receivers. More receivers than Cincinnati had defensive backs out there. Made it easy for Palco to select the fullback to throw the ball to.
Again, Matt Cavanaugh calling the plays for Pitt. He, of course, was not only an NFL linebacker, but was the MVP of that 1976 Sugar Bowl. Quarterback, pardon me, obviously. Off the right side goes Collins, so the fullback picks up about 3 yards.
Well, Cincinnati defensively doing a very nice job. They're bringing 8-9 guys down on first down, second down, daring Pitt to throw the ball deep. And then when they get into the passing situations, they're pulling their safeties out to get help on the deep ball. But on first and second down, they got a lot of guys around the line of scrimmage.
Pitt has a long ways to drive the ball if they can't get a deep ball or a big play.
Second and 7. To the near side, trying to turn the corner, is Collins, and he is popped to check that Shane Brooks. But coming up to force was John Bowie. Now, Bowie as a cornerback was a track star here in the Big East. He won the Big East 100 meters and anchored a 4x100 relay gold medal winning team last year.
Well, there's speed on both sides, and here Pitt can't get to the corner. One of the things that Pitt coaches told us was that they worried about the intensity and the flying around of Cincinnati. They said we have to match their frenzy because last week they played with a frenzy.
Well, last week Pitt made huge plays offensively against Virginia. They have 2 long touchdown passes. They haven't made any big plays so far tonight, but this could be one. A flag down as Brooks on the screen gets out across the 35 to the 37.
I think they're going to get Jeff Oda, the left tackle, for a holding call and bring this thing back. And they had a big play set up there. It was huge. They put all their receivers to the right side to the field and got folks over there and had it set up to
holding,
go back the other way.
Number 76 on the offense, 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Repeat third down.
Now see the formation. They've got receivers, three of them to the wide side of the field. That takes most of the defense out that way, and they come back to the short side of the field with the screen pass. They have it set up nicely, and there's your hold right there. A takedown, grab.
So the penalty creates third down and 9. 7.5 minutes to go before halftime. We are still scoreless. Again, last week, Pitt had 2 70-plus-yard touchdown receptions, one by Turner, one by Kinder. Palco to the near side, looking for Derek Turner, and it's knocked away. Nice coverage by Mike Mickens. It'll be fourth down, and you can sense the confidence of this Cincinnati defense building as this game progresses here in the first half.
Well, they bring a corner blitz on this. If you look at the bottom of your screen, Hakuri Nakamura, actually the safety, he comes there, but he gets picked up. Then he comes across, and it's the inside guys that actually make the hit.
Derek Stewart, driven way back to his own 28-yard line, makes the first man miss and stays on his feet out across the 41. So again, good field position for Cincinnati. Trevor Maddich mentioned how important field position would be, and they will start just shy of midfield in a moment.
We've come to the birthplace of gridlock with two cars and one goal. Get off the island first. The new 303 horsepower Lexus GS 350. You can't lose.
Bust the blandness with Fiery Buffalo Boneless Wings at KFC. Get 100% breast meat boneless wings dipped in our Fiery Buffalo sauce. Try 6 for $2.99 or 18 for $8.79. Also available in honey barbecue flavor. No bones, all flavor at KFC.
Most 16, 17-year-old kids, they make a bad choice, they get grounded. Then there's kids, they make a bad choice. Those kids get sent here.
You want to start a football team?
Exactly.
Your neck is way out on this.
If you accept this challenge, when it's all over,
gonna be winners.
Coach, I want to show people I can play.
One goal.
Now, prove to everyone out there.
A second chance.
You are somebody.
The Rock, Gridiron Gang, rated PG-13. In theaters everywhere September 15th.
You've always been competitive. That's why you choose GNC's Mega Men Sport Multivitamin. It's balanced nutrition and energy support for optimal health and athletic performance. Plus, it's enhanced with antioxidants, prostate, and heart support. At GNC, we believe a quality life starts from within. Live well.
Attention, concerned parents. Does your son like pretty girls? Does he have an upper body or torso? Does he ever wear pants with pockets? If you answered yes to any of these, then your son may already be using new Tag body shots. Consider yourself warned.
Time for something new from eBay.
eBay Express is the new place to find new items you can buy right away. From new diamond earrings to new MP3 players. eBay Express, where you'll always find it new.
Get it new. Buy it now. eBayExpress.com.
Welcome back to the fifth oldest Division I stadium still in use. This is Nippert Stadium on Cincinnati's campus. I'm Bob Wischusen with Rod Gilmore, Trevor Maddich, and Rob Similcare. ESPN2 College Football Primetime brings us to Cincinnati tonight for the River City rivalry between Cincinnati and Pitt. And so far, the Panthers have not spent 1 second tonight in Cincinnati territory. Over 5.5 minutes in Pitt territory for the Bearcats, but no points as of yet. And to the outside goes Dustin Grootsa, who again is still in at quarterback. We have not seen the quarterback switch yet, guys.
I'm very surprised about that because last week it was first quarter, third quarter for Grootsa, and second and fourth for Davila.
And but, Davila's still on the sideline.
Yeah, and we might see Davila soon if Grootsa keeps taking hits like this.
Well, again, the offensive line last year for Cincinnati allowed 40 sacks. That was last in the Big East in terms of protecting the quarterback. And already Dustin Grootsa tonight has taken some wicked shots from the Pitt defensive front. Second and 5, the inside handoff to Benton. He picks up maybe a yard. It'll be third down.
Part of leadership from a quarterback is taking those shots and jumping back up. The team sees that. They see his courage. They see him playing with pain. And the shot he took on that last pass was defensive tackle Rashad Duncan hitting it.
What do you figure? 40 sacks last year. How many hits do you think quarterback took last year?
Many more than 40. Many more.
And that's why the word this offseason was protect the quarterback. No more hits on the quarterback.
Third and four. A four-man rush. Grutza with time. Over the middle, and Selleck dropped it. That would have been an easy first down for Cincinnati, but Selleck couldn't hold on. Sam Bryant was there in coverage.
Selleck is far and away their best offensive weapon. They need him to make these plays. Now, this was a great pass right in the stomach, but it was a good hit coming in that dislodged that ball before Selleck could put it away. They need Selleck to put those away.
Oh, he's got to catch that ball. He's a go-to guy. He's their go-to receiver. He's got great hands. He normally would have that ball. Had it even been on the ground, he would have come up with it.
Again, Brian Steele, the junior college transfer, gets away a wobbly kick. Revis from his 11 trying to take field position back for the Panthers and can't quite do it. Out to the 17-yard line. 5:14 to go before halftime. Halco comes back again inside his own 20.
You don't know what we can find. Why do you come with me now? On the magic carpet ride.
Now there's a new frascata at Wendy's, the new frascata italiana. Like all genuine Italian sandwiches, it's served on freshly baked artisan bread, topped with real Genoa salami, lean ham, natural Swiss, roasted peppers, and sun-dried tomato vinaigrette. For an Italian original, go to Wendy's and do what tastes right.
We've come to the birthplace of gridlock with two cars and one goal. Get off the island first. The new 303 horsepower Lexus GS 350. You can't lose.
Long Island? Call Colorado and talk as long as you like. Newark? Gossip with Chicago for hours. Westchester? Call Florida and conference in California. Because with Optimum Voice, you can talk to anyone, anywhere for as long as you like. Unlimited local and long distance calling for as low as $29.95 per month. And you can even keep your current phone number. Optimum Voice, rated number one by readers of PC Magazine. 13 premium calling features like enhanced voicemail and My Optimum Voice, your personal website to turn on all of your great new features. All for one low price with no hidden charges or confusing fees. Now everyone in the tri-state area can be heard throughout the U.S., Canada, and Puerto Rico. Unlimited local and long distance calling for one flat rate. For as low as $29.95 per month, call 1-866-VOICE-05 and join the thousands switching every day.
$9.99, available only at Sprint or Nextel retailers. Call 800-NEXTEL-9. Nextel, only from Sprint.
Welcome back to Cincinnati. The Bearcats fans have watched their defense come out and dominate field position here in the first half. No score with 5:14 remaining before halftime. This is college football primetime on ESPN2. The opener in the Big East Conference for both the Panthers and the Bearcats. Palco drops. Throws it deep for Kinder. Kinder makes the catch. For the first time tonight, Pitt into Cincinnati territory. What a catch by Derek Kinder.
And what were we just talking about during the break? We're talking about the frustration of not getting the ball down the field and having to just sit in the sights of your own goalpost. Palco was ready to toss the ball out there. You knew he was ready to get rid of it and throw it down the field. He's an emotional quarterback. He wants to make plays. And he was so tired and frustrated of sitting back near his own goal line.
First and 10, a big gain across the 50 now. 37-yard gain in all for the Panthers. Again, Palco play action, buying some time. This time it's Turner, knocked away by Mike Nickens.
Mickens was second team All Big East selection as a true freshman last year.
I think this is offensive coordinator Matt Kavanaugh recognizing that his quarterback needs to turn it loose, that he had him bottled up most of the game, and that sooner or later Palco was going to lose it. So, you know, go ahead, give him a chance to throw the ball down the field.
And they're keeping the running back in to give him extra time to do that.
A very difficult throw attempted there by Palco as well from the near side to the far side of the field. Looked as if it gave Mickens just enough time to close and knock it away. Second down and 10. The handoff to Kevin Collier, and the true freshman picks up about 4 yards.
You see, now you can keep running your offense if you're Matt Kavanaugh because you've satisfied your quarterback. I mean, you've told him, okay, you know, throw it down the field. All right, come and throw another one. Let's go back and run the ball now.
And then you satisfy your offensive line by allowing a little bit of smash mouth up the middle. That time guard C.J. Davis, number 55, on the left of your screen there, drove a defender into the ground with his shoulder.
Still well outside of field goal range for the Panthers, so a chance for Cincinnati's defense to get off the field. They've lost field position, but they might get the football back if they can stop the 3rd and 6. Here comes the blitz. Palco hit as he throws. It falls incomplete. The pocket collapsed. Trevor Anderson got there and hit Palco on the release. It's a big play for the Cincinnati defense.
It is, but here's the game we're in now. Field position, as we look at Matt Kavanaugh, didn't think that Palco did the right thing. He wanted to get rid of the ball quickly.
I think he was concerned about the protection and that they didn't call the right protection or didn't check out of that play with that blitz coming.
A wobbly kick by Gressel. Fair catch called for and made by Derek Stewart. This is Friday Night Football, but again, Monday Night Football begins on ESPN in 2 days. For more on that, here's Mike Tirico.
Four teams, two coasts, one memorable Monday night. Joe Gibbs and Washington begin their championship run against former Redskin Brad Johnson and the Vikings. Then Chargers starlet Damian Tomlinson visits Randy Moss and the Raiders. Vikings, Redskins, Chargers, Raiders, starting at 7 Eastern, a doubleheader season premiere of ESPN's Monday Night Football.
I've been enjoying Tony Kornheiser in the preseason on Monday nights.
Yeah, I think that's a good move, and Chad Johnson's probably enjoyed it too because he likes controversy, he likes things different. We all enjoy Chad Johnson.
Now there is a blonde mohawk underneath that hat. You can just see a bit coming out. Greg Moore is the tailback. Grootsa to the wide side, finds his man. It's Ernest Jackson, and Jackson very close to a first down, as it appears the entire first half is going to belong to Dustin Grootsa.
I think you're absolutely right. We're not going to see Davila in this first half. I think that's smart. After you kept him on the sideline for so long, you might as well let him wait to the second half to play. Yeah, you know, but getting back to Chad Johnson, you know, this town is a Cincinnati Bengal town. I mean, they really love the Bengals, and they love their high school football. So Cincinnati, University of Cincinnati, tends to be in third place behind those two.
And that is something that Mark D'Antonio told us sometimes rubs him the wrong way, but that he is very much wanting to change. Roots of pressure. And throws it away. D'Antonio actually told us as well that he was irked a bit when no one came from Cincinnati to Big East Media Day earlier this season. He just felt as if that the program is not being paid attention to the way he would like it in this market.
But he also knows that what he has to do is get marquee players and win. And some of the best high school football in the state is played in Cincinnati at places like Elder and Coleraine and St. X. And they're getting a lot of players from there. And the more that come and see these great facilities and what D'Antonio is doing, the more will come. And he believes he's got a sound foundation to build.
Second down and 10, under 3 minutes to go in the first half. Grootsa again in pressure and throws an interception. They tried the screen, and Kennard Cox read it, jumped up and picked it off, and now Pitt has the football in the red zone.
He never saw Kennard Cox. Cox kind of got down really low, snuck into the backfield. He was in a press coverage situation up top, and then he just kind of snuck up on in there, and he was never seen. Look to the right of your screen. In the last second, you'll see him sneaking right on in there.
Gus Mostakis got in the way of the throwing motion of his arm as well.
So for the first time tonight, Cincinnati's defense with their backs up against it. Palco with a first down at the 18. They go to the ground, and getting down to the 15-yard line is Shane Brooks, a gain of three.
This game would make Bo Schembechler and Woody Hayes happy. Two teams going at it, not taking great risks, and waiting for the other to make a mistake. This is the first big mistake of the game, and now we've got the first true scoring opportunity.
Well, I think Pittsburgh really also is missing their fine running back, the Rod Stevens Howling. I mean, he is such a difference maker for them. He adds that quickness, that ability to get out in the flat and make a guy miss, and I think their offense needs that tonight.
Play action. Palco pumps, fires towards the end zone. Touchdown. Oderick Turner, who caught a 72-yard touchdown pass in the second quarter last week. That was one of the biggest plays in the win over Virginia. Comes up with a 15-yard touchdown catch. So the son of former New York Giant wide receiver Odessa Turner breaks the ice.
A very nice route. Plenty of time for Palco to find him. Notice he catches the ball with his hands. Watch the end of this. You think that's not an emotional quarterback? You think he wasn't frustrated that he couldn't get into the end zone before now?
Connor Lee, a sophomore, on for the point after. And it's 7-0 Pitt. It was a big play offense last week for Pitt. This time they take advantage of the turnover and take the lead.
My company was testing new armor plating for the military.
We were designing this new multimedia center.
My company was launching a new energy drink.
The stuff had to stop a 50 caliber bullet.
Then the sound engineer changes all the specs at midnight.
We tested in Denver, LA.
We worked every weekend.
The clock was ticking.
There was no room for error.
The initial sales were through the roof.
We really made a difference.
We pulled it off.
I wanted to build my future. At the University of Pittsburgh, I learned with the best students. Pitt students win top national and international scholarships. And Pitt's alumni, they receive the world's top prizes. Pitt's athletes are among the best ever. And Pitt's ranked in the top 20 national public universities. At school, people build their future. At Pitt, we're building our future together.
Kennard Cox, the interception, sets up a two-play, 18-yard touchdown drive, capped by Oderick Turner. 15-yard touchdown reception thrown by Tyler Palco, 50 seconds. And again, this is the first drive that started outside the 20-yard line for Pitt. It started inside Cincinnati's 20. That makes a big difference.
How about Turner? He's only a freshman. He could be the next in a long line of great receivers that we've seen at Pitt over the years.
Derek Stewart on the return. Squeezes across the 20-yard line. For a look at what is coming up on our halftime report, back to Bristol and Reese Davis.
All right, guys, Lou and Mark joining me on the Olive Garden halftime report. We've got plenty coming on the Lone Star Showdown and the rest of Saturday's action. Get you up to date on the women's final that is now set at the U.S. Open. What's the Texas-Ohio State game going to turn on?
We're going to tell you what the key position on any football team is, and it's not the kicker.
I'm going to tell you who's going to win the big game, and it has something to do with defense, Rod Gilmore. I bet you can guess who I'm going to pick.
It wouldn't be the secondary, would it?
Nah.
Grutza underneath to Dominic Goodwin, a 2-yard gain, and quickly calling timeout. Cincinnati with 1:18
Cincinnati
remaining.
That is their first
and the coach, Mark May, and Reese Davis just mentioned it. A reminder, the clash of the Titans tomorrow night on ABC. Number one and number two, Ohio State and Texas. Jim Tressel and the Buckeyes head to Austin to take on Mac Brown's Longhorns. And we will have it for you on ABC at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. College football lives here.
Well, you see the quarterback comparison going into this ball game. Smith, the more experienced. McCoy, the young guy. But, you know, after the brilliant setup by my good buddy Mark May, it's all about defense. You know that. And if you're talking about defense, you got to be talking about Texas. I mean, that's a defense that is ready to play. Ohio State, they've got talent, but that defense had a little trouble last week against Northern Illinois.
They did, but they had to replace 9 new starters. Now, those guys are fast, but they've got to get cohesive, and it's kind of tough to get cohesive in just the second game against such a powerful offensive line and running game as Texas. But, you know, I don't know that defense is the key here, Rod. I think it's going to come down to the quarterbacks, and it's going to come down to a big play or a mistake by the quarterbacks. And I think Ohio State with Troy Smith has the edge.
Sometimes, always about though, the defense and the offensive line, pal.
Well, Rod, sometimes don't those mistakes made by quarterbacks have a lot to do with the defense?
Absolutely.
Second down and six after the timeout. Grootsa under pressure. Horse collared, still finds a way to get it to Selleck. And once again, Selleck can't hold on. Grootsa has been pressured throughout the first half.
And as he throws this through this ball, I was afraid for him because he's under control of the defender and he still throws it out there. But look where this ball gets to. Look where Selleck has a chance to catch this ball right there in the hands, even though Grootsa was being dragged down at the point of the release.
I guess you'd have to characterize that as a drop. And that's the second drop for Brent Selleck here in the first half. Third down and six. Again, Grootsa forced out of the pocket to the outside, and again a low throw that could have been handled. Derek Stewart unable to come up with it. It will be fourth down.
You know, talking to Dave Wonstadt before the ball game, he said, "Hey, is Mark May in the studio tonight?" I said, "Yeah, sure is." He said, "You know, Mark is just killing me. He wants 10-2. He wants a 10-2 season all the time, unless you get a national championship."
Well, there was a time in Pitt football when 10-2 was far from out of the question, and that's obviously what Dave Wonstadt thinks his program can become again. Steal the punt, gets it away. Revis, returnable from the 34. Trying to use his speed to get to the outside, and can't turn the corner. Flags down on the far side of the field as well, with 51 seconds to go before halftime, and this will be holding against Pitt. That will force the Panthers back a bit further.
During the return, holding number 19, 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
And again, Saturday night, there's even more college football on ESPN and ESPN2. On ESPN2 at 6:30, Mike Stoops and the Arizona Wildcats go into Tiger Stadium to battle LSU. And then at 7:45 on ESPN, it's Steve Spurrier and South Carolina against Mark Richt's Georgia Bulldogs. College football primetime on ESPN and ESPN2. Saturday, also available in high definition on ESPN HD and ESPN2 HD. On the change of possession, the clock rolls as the Panthers come up to the line. Already inside of 40 seconds. Two timeouts left for Pitt. Not opting to use one here. And it's an inside handoff to Collins. He spins for about 8 yards.
Pitt certainly content to grind out the clock and go in with a halftime lead and making sure they don't have a turnover by giving the ball to Collins and not to the freshman.
Well, they still stay in the shotgun. Seems odd with two timeouts. If they wanted to go hurry up, they wouldn't have called one. Now we're inside of 5 seconds. It'll be one last play and a handoff to Collins. And that will do it for the first half. So the biggest play of the first half, certainly the interception by Kennard Cox. That turned into a 15-yard touchdown pass from Tyler Palko to Oderic Turner. And, guys, that's it for scoring here in the first half.
And it was the style of play. Field position and wait for the mistake from the other team. Cincinnati made the mistake. Pittsburgh took advantage.
I think we're going to see quarterback number two for Cincinnati in the second half. Nick Davila, I'm certain, will come on the field for Cincinnati.
Although there were a lot of drop passes for Grootsa. He actually did quite well. If it weren't for those drops, they'd have been better.
Got to get points.
And if Davila's in the game, does that necessarily mean that the protection is going to improve? Because Grootsa obviously was hit a fair amount in the first half as well.
The protection will improve if they can catch those balls, though. They've got to catch passes. They'll move the ball, which affects the defense.
As far as the Pitt mindset is concerned, Dave Wonstadt is with our Rob Simulcare.
All right, Coach Wonstadt, you spent almost the entire first half on your side of the field until that turnover late. What's your assessment of the offensive performance so far?
Well, you know, they're putting a lot of pressure on us. I mean, they're doing a great job on defense, running and pass-wise, and we've got to just keep our composure a little bit and be able to handle the pressure more, run and pass. I'm not talking about just pass protection. But and then we had the one turnover, and we mishandled a punt, so we didn't help ourselves with the field position.
Meanwhile, on the defensive side of the ball, after the good effort last week, you got a goose egg up there on the other side so far today. What's keying that?
Well, you know, sometimes that's the way the game goes. We got 30 minutes left. We get the ball. We come out the second half. We got to regroup and get our minds together. We got a long second half.
All right, Coach. Thank you. Bob, back up to you.
All right, Rob, 7-0 Pitt at halftime. And now it's time for the Olive Garden halftime report. We go back to our ESPN studios. Lou Holtz, Mark May, and Reese Davis.
This is the Olive Garden halftime report.
Late touchdown, giving Pittsburgh the lead at the break. When we continue on the Olive Garden halftime report, we'll turn our attention to number one against number two. Ohio State and Texas in Austin on Saturday night. We'll tell you who the key player in that game might be and how the game will turn. And we'll also show you a guy who virtually single-handedly turned around the fortunes not only of his team, but an entire conference.
Saturday Night Football on ABC, Ohio State versus Texas, this Saturday at 8.
Introducing the rebirth of cool. Gatorade Rain. Start crisp, finish clean. Stay cool in the heat. Gatorade Rain.
This fall, football takes center stage. In theaters, The Rock stars in Gridiron Gang.
Now is the time to prove to everyone out there
you are somebody.
And on the field.
Nobody's gonna catch it. You can forget about it.
Football lives here. Gridiron Gang opens in theaters September 15th. And watch college football all season long on ESPN, ESPN2, and ABC.
There are no shortcuts, no easy way to the top. When your mind and body tell you you can't continue, your heart takes over. You feel pain and fatigue, but your eyes stay focused on the goal. You play for pride, respect, and the chance to compete in the BCS to win the Big East Championship. Every practice, every game, every day, you play to be the best.
I smoke while I'm watching cartoons. I have my first cigarette of the day when I get up.
We smoke in the car on the way to school.
I smoke while I'm coloring.
I smoke during my nap.
When you smoke around your kids,
I'm down to about a pack a day.
It's like they're smoking. Secondhand smoke can hurt their lung growth and permanently damage lung functions.
I tried quitting. I need to try again.
Secondhand smoke, it's nothing to kid about.
Now, in less time than you ever imagined, you can breathe new life into your basement and add much-needed living space to your home with the Owens Corning Basement Finishing System. Finishing fact number 17. Installing drywall can take months, but our system is installed in about 2 weeks with virtually no mess. So in practically no time, you'll not only finish your basement, you'll transform your home.
Call 1-800-NEW-BASE now for a free video plus a free design consultation. It's a fact. Nobody knows basements better than Owens Corning.
Welcome back to the Olive Garden Halftime Report.
One versus two. Buckeyes, Longhorns. So much at stake, so early in the season. 8 p.m. Eastern in prime time. ESPN on ABC. It's Ohio State and Texas on Saturday Night Football.
One versus two is special. It doesn't come along all the time in the regular season. First time it has happened in 10 years since Florida and Florida State played in a regular season 1-2 matchup. Horns riding that 21-game winning streak and a three-point victory in the horseshoe last year. So Texas and Ohio State, Saturday night, you can see it on ABC and Troy Smith. Troy Smith says that he wants to be like a surgeon in at least the early returns against Northern Illinois. He looked like one at quarterback.
I think he's an excellent quarterback, and the most important position by far is quarterback. You look at Arizona State's been in the Pac-10 28 years, never had an all-conference Pac quarterback, and they've not been in the Rose Bowl. That's why Ohio State's going to win. Troy Smith is outstanding, particularly in the big games. He's 14-2 as a starter. 6-1 against ranked teams. He can throw it. He can run it. In the big game, he shows up, Mark.
Well, both teams are going to score offensively, but the key is
which team has the better defense, and that's the Texas Longhorns. They can get up the field and put pressure on the quarterback, Brian Robinson, Tim Crowder, the defensive ends, speedy linebackers, and Robert Killebrew. But here's the key, guys. This is where the rubber meets the road. They're used to going against a mobile quarterback. Who was their starting quarterback in practice all last year? What is his name? Vince Young, drafted by the NFL draft?
He was fairly mobile.
There you go. So they know how to go against a mobile quarterback and how to shut one down. And you look at this offense against that defense, I think it's a huge advantage for the Texas defense. Gene Chizik will have those guys salty and ready to play.
It's an excellent point you made, Lou, about Arizona without benefit of an all-conference quarterback. And now Colt McCoy hoping to play well enough for Texas to provide that upset. And if you think Ohio State's not ready for this thing, Kirk Barton, their offensive tackle, said, "This game means everything for our season." Pretty much the way Chris Fowler and the guys feel.
The quiet before the chaos in Austin, Texas. The Buckeyes and the Longhorns on Saturday night. The first 1-2 collision here in more than a half century. You old-timers, Kyle Rote Sr. was the quarterback at SMU when the Longhorns got him back here in 1950. So let's go to speed drills and give me a difference maker, positive or negative, in the ballgame here.
Well, I think it's going to be Troy Smith, the quarterback at Ohio State. And the reason is Texas's defense is very well coached. They got beautiful schemes. But the way to beat the Texas defense is down in broken plays. And that's where I think Troy Smith will be dangerous. If I was a Texas defense, I'd be worried about him breaking a play and throwing that ball or running it. I like that kid a lot.
Yeah, running and throwing. Yeah. That's what makes him so effective. I think Colt McCoy of Texas, so much is around Colt McCoy. He's got an offensive line, got great backs, great receivers, everything that he needs to have an effective night. But it's the first time he's been in this kind of atmosphere. How will he handle that kind of crowd, that kind of pressure? And especially, Chris, the first time he hits adversity in this game, how does he respond to that adversity? His performance could decide the outcome of the game.
Well, speaking of quarterbacks, there is grave concern in the Notre Dame nation. Brady Quinn's off night in the opener, no touchdown passes. Now here comes Penn State into South Bend with its young quarterback. Give me a key to that game, Irish Nittany Lions.
Well, I think Anthony Morelli, the throwing quarterback from Penn State, and the reason why, this is very important. Penn State has five really good wideouts who can run and catch the football. And Penn State will test the Notre Dame secondary.
Well, they're going to test that Notre Dame secondary, but the Notre Dame defense, I think, as a group, will put a lot of pressure on Anthony Morelli. They're going to disguise coverages. They're going to try to get him to throw the ball into coverage. Again, another quarterback facing an atmosphere and a defense that he's never seen before. Mm-hmm. How will he respond to that? Big key in that game.
You understand the grave concern was among the Notre Dame fans, not the team. Brady Quinn's going to be just fine on that side of the football.
Yeah, that offense is fine.
All right, besides these two biggest games of Saturday, give me an intriguing game to watch.
Well, I live in Orlando, Florida. This is the University of Central Florida from Orlando against the mighty Gators in Gainesville. And the reason I'm saying this is a game where the old Gators are looking ahead to Tennessee. Watch out. This game is closer than the experts think. George O'Leary can coach.
He sure
can. And UCF has got some pretty good football players.
All right, we're going to keep an eye on that one. A little bit off the radar there for us. I'll keep an eye on that one. South Carolina and Georgia, to me, is a game that I'm looking forward to seeing. We saw South Carolina in person. Their defense is flying. Georgia, the quarterback situation a little dicey. They play it in Columbia. South Carolina, maybe a potential upset there.
Usually very close and low scoring when those schools face. Gamecocks have won 6 in a row in the SEC. You've also got Clemson, BC, Oregon, Fresno State. So some intriguing
good games.
Overshadowed, of course, by this big monster showdown here in Austin, Texas, which will be a lot of fun to talk about on College Game Day. We'll tackle all the angles, plus the two sports hour. It's not Bo, it's not Dion. He is a pitcher on the Irish baseball team and a catcher of Brady Quinn's passes, Jeff Samardzija. The Vols, big win in the opener. As Tennessee back, we'll go all access with the new/old offensive coordinator. And Longhorn quarterback Colt McCoy, we talked about him, a hero even before he arrived here on campus. We'll tell you why.
And this is the man who statistically had the best day at quarterback of any signal caller in the country. LSU has a showdown, and Matt Ryan's been gimpy. We'll get an update.
This halftime report brought to you by Olive Garden. When you're here, you're family.
What's the never-ending pasta bowl?
Oh, just pick as many sauce and pasta combinations as you want. We'll keep them coming.
Now that would bring him endless happiness.
It's Olive Garden's never-ending pasta bowl with great sauces like new spinach Alfredo and our 5-cheese marinara. Pick any combination of sauce and pasta, then another. Try them all for just $7.95, plus endless breadsticks and salad.
Maybe we could try endless allowance at home.
Olive Garden, when you're here, you're family.
Spin
spending limit. Who cares?
Not us, because them ain't all credit cards.
Sure ain't.
Them motorcycles was expensive and fast.
And loud.
Oh, yeah. Them bikes be like, wah.
No, no, like.
They went like, wah. Sound good, because they free. Shoot.
Yeah, shoot.
City Identity Theft Solutions. Talk to a real person to help get your life back. Free when you get a Citi credit card or Citibank account.
This is the Olive Garden Halftime Report.
I'm Lisa Salters in Austin, where the Ohio State team has already arrived, along with an estimated 40,000 Buckeye fans. The team walkthrough at 8 o'clock tonight. As for the Longhorns, with starting cornerback Terrell Brown suspended after being arrested on misdemeanor marijuana and gun possession charges, the team got a motivational visit at yesterday's practice from Lance Armstrong. Armstrong told players, "I know what it's like to be surrounded by controversy. It's been a rough week for you, but you've got to play as a team and get past it."
I'm Holly Rowe in Columbia, South Carolina. Folks in the South seem to love things on a stick. Corn dogs on a stick, chicken on a stick, and in today's local paper, they've got Spurrier on a stick. It's a do-it-yourself mask they're encouraged to bring to tomorrow's game. I asked Coach how he felt about it. He said, "Well, it's fine. It's one way to sell papers." But he said, "Holly, I really hope our players make enough plays against Georgia that they're in the paper next time."
I'm Dave Lamont in Baton Rouge. I'm sure it's quiet now, but it won't be on Saturday when Arizona faces LSU. So Wildcats coach Mike Stoops made sure his players knew what they were facing by pumping in some extra crowd noise during practice. He'll also be facing a very confident quarterback in Jamarcus Russell, who told us that he's finally healthy after suffering wrist and shoulder injuries last season. And that's a shoulder he won't be looking over, because he knows now he is the number one quarterback in Baton Rouge, and it's not even close.
Stacey Dales with you in Chestnut Hill, Massachusetts. The news here is whether or not starting Boston College quarterback Matt Ryan will start in tomorrow's game versus Clemson. He injured his ankle, a high ankle sprain, just a week ago. He returned to full practice yesterday. I asked him how it feels. He said, "It feels sore, but he's moving around very well. Did return to practice, and it will be a game time decision," as Coach Tom O'Brien told us today.
I'm Rob Stone in Chapel Hill, where Virginia Tech's team bus an hour late today for their team walkthrough due to traffic problems driving down from Blacksburg. On that bus, redshirt sophomore Nick Marshman, who due to an injury will make his first collegiate start and will be at left tackle, protecting the blind side of new Hokie QB Sean Glennon. Also on the bus, wide receiver Eddie Royal. His 20-game consecutive start streak will be snapped Saturday, but he will be able to play versus the Tar Heels.
Well, Tyler Palco wishes he had a little bit more protection from his blind side. Cincinnati getting some heat on the Pitt quarterback, with the Panthers up by a touch.
This Halftime Report brought to you by Olive Garden. When you're here, you're family. We're back to see what happens when you don't use degree. Today's match, Oder versus a best man winging his speech. Ooh, and the bride just got a noseful.
He should have used degree deodorant.
Its body-responsive formula prevents odor from existing all day.
You've always been competitive. That's why you choose GNC's Mega Men Sport Multivitamin. It's balanced nutrition and energy support for optimal health and athletic performance. Plus, it's enhanced with antioxidants, prostate, and heart support. At GNC, we believe a quality life starts from within. Live well.
XP Tablet PC Edition.
This is your home. This is your business. This is your home phone and computer.
This is your business phone and computer. You pay $29.95 each for home phone and internet service. You pay $29.95 each for business. When you get the Optimum Double Play, get the most reliable internet access with Optimum Online and experience speeds 5 times faster than DSL. With Optimum Voice, you'll get unlimited calling in the U.S., Canada, and Puerto Rico. Better internet access and better telephone service for one flat rate of $29.95 a month each. With Optimum Double Play for home, you'll start saving your first year. With Optimum Double Play for business, you'll save even more your first year with no contracts or hidden fees. And switching is risk-free with our 30-day money-back guarantee. So remember, this is your home, this is your business, and this is what you'll pay with Optimum, just $29.95 per month each. Call 1-877-778-FAST to get the better choice, the Optimum Double Play. Millions are already saving at home and work. You can too. Call now.
Well, last night, Ian Johnson of Boise State single-handedly ended a 21-game losing streak for WAC teams against clubs from the big BCS conferences. Look at the numbers he put up in the 42-14 win, guys.
Talk about a dark horse for the Heisman Trophy. Why not Ian? 240 yards?
I'm thinking BCS buster for sure. New liberalized BCS rules in the extra game, Boise State. A force in the WAC, and Ian Johnson just ran through a tackling optional Beaver defense, too.
I hope there's room on his helmet for a sticker.
Hey, take your pick right now. Maria Sharapova or Emily Maresmo in the U.S. Open semis?
I think Sharapova.
Good call. She took the first set 6-love. In the second set, Maresmo fighting back, and after a long rally, she'll deliver a nice forehand winner. It made no one screech. She took the second set 6-4. First set, Sharapova's dropped in the open. In the third set, Sharapova up 1-love. She would take that game, too, to go up 2-love. Later, 5-love and serving for the match. She bookended whitewashings. 6-love, 6-love in the first and third. Lost the second 4-6, and Sharapova going on to the U.S. Open Final, where she will face Justine Anna Ardan for the championship. Phillies and Marlins, bottom of the eighth, and Ryan Howard continues to swat balls over the fence at an alarming rate. 56 home runs now for Howard as the Phillies have a 3-1 lead. Jamie Moyer digging in, standpoint of what he brings to the table, a lot of veteran savvy, and the Phillies have a 3-1 lead there. Oh, Derek Turner hauling in the pass from Tyler Palco. Only score the first half, second half's coming.
What's the never-ending pasta bowl?
Oh, just pick as many sauce and pasta combinations as you want. We'll keep them coming.
Now that would bring him endless happiness.
It's Olive Garden's never-ending pasta bowl with great sauces like new spinach Alfredo and our 5-cheese marinara. Pick any combination of sauce and pasta, then another. Try them all for just $7.95, plus endless breadsticks and salad.
Maybe we could try endless allowance at home.
Olive Garden, when you're here, you're family.
I've lived my whole life on the Gulf Coast, but when Katrina hit, I ended up in Massapequa, New York.
Roseville, Michigan.
Dyersburg, Tennessee.
We ended up in Aniana, Alabama. They chartered a bus and drove 300 miles to get us out of there. They told us we weren't going to be comfortable till y'all get comfortable. Turns out Tom's not with the bus company. He's with State Farm.
Just lost everything. Honestly, thank God for Anita. She asked me what I did for a living and found me a job.
Without Cheryl, we would have been on the street.
That money helped me to be strong for my children.
And I really thank State Farm for that.
Mike made 4 round trips from Oregon to Mississippi to bring us beds and supplies.
All across the country, State Farm agents have helped.
And every day, we continue to help those affected by Katrina.
People say New Orleans was the forgotten city, but I wasn't forgotten.
How would you thank somebody for saving your life and turning it back around again?
There are no shortcuts, no easy way to the top. When your mind and body tell you you can't continue, your heart takes over. You feel pain and fatigue, but your eyes stay focused on the goal. You play for pride, respect, and the chance to compete in the BCS. To win the Big East Championship. Every practice, every game, every day, you play to be the best.
ESPN2 Primetime College Football, broadcast in high definition, presented by Pioneer Plasma.
as we are set for the start of the second half. It is a one-score game here in Cincinnati, and we take a look at our game track. The first half was a tale of the front lines for both teams getting pressure on the quarterback. Cincinnati pressuring Tyler Bocco, but then Pittsburgh pressuring Grootsa, and that forces the interception. Kennard Cox with the pick, and Oderic Turner with the touchdown catch. It is 7-0 Pitt as we are set for the start of the second half. Cincinnati played field position throughout almost the entirety of the first half. Unfortunately, though, they lost field position and lost the lead in a scoreless game. Really all on one play. And the second half now underway. And a kickoff out of the back of the end zone. Mike D'Antonio, a moment ago, spoke with Rob Simulcare.
All right, Coach D'Antonio, first half, your offense struggled a bit. You stayed with the one quarterback the entire first half. What should we expect to see the second half?
Well, we'll come out with Nick the second half, Nick Davila, and see how we do. But, you know, we're making plays. We beat ourselves. We got down there. We faked the field goal, you know. But we're getting after it. We're playing well defensively. One turnover's hurt us.
What happened on that field goal attempt? We talked about special teams being an issue for you guys last year in this game. What was that play?
Well, we thought we had a play to be made on him, and the guy came off the opposite side. The kicker was supposed to try and nick him, and Revis made a great play. If not for that, the guy's probably in the end zone, but that's life.
All right, Coach, thanks.
Kinder down the sideline, breaks into the open. One big play was made in the first half by Pitt. Here's another. Kinder goes the distance for the touchdown. Like lightning, it's a two-touchdown lead for the Panthers. We haven't even played 30 seconds of the third quarter. 80 yards.
Well, that's one of the big differences in this Pitt team. They have speed now at the skill spot to make plays. Kinder faked a block and then came outside and just delayed out there waiting for Palco to throw the ball to him, and then showed you some great skills down the sideline, great running
the
skills.
The prior play is under review.
They may want to see whether or not Derek Kinder stepped on the sideline at some point. That last look seemed as if he was able to stay in bounds. A somewhat innocent looking hitch play as Palco was under some pressure, found Kinder, and Kinder ran 75 yards. Does he touch the chalk at any point?
Can't hard tell to tell from that angle. Yeah. You'd have to say from that angle, you don't have enough video evidence to overturn the call. How about from this angle? Looks like the left foot is inbounds, right foot inbounds, left again inbounds. He's inbounds. There's no black shoe on the white sideline there at all. That's good.
Again, it has to be indisputable video evidence to overturn it.
I think that's indisputable. That's a touchdown.
Absolutely. Well, this will be a Pitt touchdown after all is said and done from the replay booth. As last week, Pitt scored two touchdowns on passes of over 70 yards. This one goes for 80, but Palco didn't throw it too deep, only threw a five-yard out, and Kinder did the rest.
One of the things that Dave Wanstead's staff
after
has
review,
done.
The ruling on the field is confirmed. Touchdown.
They've simplified the schemes and made their players tougher so that they could make plays like this.
How about Wanstead on that replay? Did you see him running down the sideline behind Kinder? You think he's not into the ball game?
Well, Haruki Nakamura and Antoine Horton, I'm sure, would like to have that play back. They both missed tackles on the sideline for Cincinnati. Connor Lee for the point after. And it's 14-0 Pitt. So the fans here at Cincinnati barely make their way back from halftime. And Derek Kinder, who now has 117 yards tonight on two catches.
And he had a 70-yard touchdown last week against Virginia. There's a big play component to this Pitt offense, something they did not have last season.
Well, part of that's the toughness. By simplifying the schemes, they know better what to do. And instead of thinking, they can just play hard. And all offseason, last offseason, every Friday, the coach Wanstead took his players to different landmarks in Pittsburgh to run. He did all kinds of things to make them tougher so they wouldn't have to think. They could just beat their opponent physically, and that's what we saw Kinder do.
He's also done a great job of really going out and finding some good speed, some talent. He's recruited down in Florida, a place that he worked at Miami and the University of Miami. So he knows how to go out and bring some guys in here, and he's committed to making this a faster program, and I think it's showing up tonight.
Yeah, we talk about that recruiting. They've got 11 All-State high school players from Pennsylvania. 11 All-State Pennsylvania high school players in this recruiting class. They've got two All-States from Florida, a couple from Ohio. They've got one from New York. They're recruiting.
Six defensive starters have come from Florida. Derek Stewart tries to bring it back, gets out across the 30-yard line. So decent field position, at least, for Cincinnati. But they now trail 14 to nothing. And this was a game that was nothing-nothing up until the last 3 minutes of the first half.
And you have a new quarterback, and remember, he didn't play in the first half at all. So, by and large, Nick Davila has been standing on the sideline for almost 2 hours, kind of getting cold.
Physically getting cold, but mentally, he's got an advantage. He's able to see what Pitt has been trying to do, see the good things and the bad things that happened in the first half.
Davila saw action in 5 games in his first year with Cincinnati. Did not play much, mostly in mop-up duty, and now puts his knee down. So the first play for Davila turns into a self-induced 7-yard loss.
Well, I can't say that I'm surprised. It's almost like being a pinch hitter in baseball. I mean, you sit on the bench for a couple of hours, and then you're asked to come in and do something great. That's hard to do. So I'm not surprised that on his first play, he has a little bit of an issue. But as he warms up, he might do very well.
And Rod, that issue was the mesh point with Butler Benton, the running back. He got too close to Benton on the fake handoff, and their feet crossed.
A loss of 8, second down and 18. And this game has turned very quickly in favor of Pitt. Now to the ground, not much there for Benton. Maybe a yard. Gus Mostakis stood him up in the middle.
Well, Davila now is really going to have to be unleashed. They aren't really going to be able to be too conservative. Now, for 2 years, he was a junior college All-American quarterback. Simple offense. He just winged it around. It took him all last year to really get comfortable with this scheme. But now Cincinnati has to hope that he is.
I think if you're Don Treadwell, the offensive coordinator, you have to be conservative here because your quarterback was shaky on the first play, and you've got 3rd and 16. You don't want a big turnover here to end the ballgame.
Only 104 yards tonight of total offense for Cincinnati. And Davila this time, not a self-imposed sack. Doug Fulmer brings him down for the loss. 3 downs and out for Cincinnati.
Keep your eye on the left side of the screen. There's Fulmer out there. You see they have the tight end on that side, staying in to help block. Doesn't get it done. I'm sorry, Fulmer comes from the opposite side, the left side there, and gets in for the tackle.
You're right, Rod, because there were 8 guys stayed in the block. You see the running back, Ben, and they got him anyway.
Grievous from the 30. Tries to pick up a block as a flag comes down, and he gained 5 yards. We'll have to check the penalty. Pitt with a 14-0 lead. And it looks as if they are going to hurt themselves field position-wise with a penalty here. But how about Cincinnati now with under 100 yards of total offense after the loss on the sack?
During the return, holding, number 38, 10-yard penalty from the end of the play, first down.
So Cincinnati under 100 yards of total offense. Pitt has 110 yards after the catch. What a job by their receivers tonight, and they have the lead.
Where should you be right up until kickoff?
You guessed it.
The crew is back for another season of Countdown. Can Tio and the Tuna get along? And is Carson better than ever? Sunday NFL Countdown, 11 a.m. on ESPN.
Friday, it's casual day, so hopefully you're taking full advantage. If that's not enough, it's only 3 days till a doubleheader on Monday night. 3 days till the Vikings face the Redskins at 7 o'clock and the Chargers take on the Raiders at 10:15.
Second down line from their own 35. That's open line is...
Wild Wings. You have to be here.
Every day, workers across America cover our good name with dirt, dust, paint, oil, grease, and mud. And you know what? We're fine with that. Dickies, a legend in work.
Time for something new from eBay.
eBay Express is the new place to find new items you can buy right away. From new cashmere sweaters to new golf clubs, eBay Express, where you'll always find it new.
Get it new, buy it now. eBayExpress.com. Time for something new from eBay.
eBay Express is the new place to find new items you can buy right away. From new plasma TVs to new power drills, eBay Express, where you'll always find it new.
Get it new, buy it now. eBayExpress.com.
It's been a tough night for the Cincinnati offense, as right now the offensive linemen are getting an earful on the Cincinnati sideline, trailing 14-0. But Tyler Palco with two touchdown passes, and those two touchdown passes have come in terms of game action in the last 6 minutes to give Pitt the 14-0 lead. Handoff inside, Shane Brooks for a couple of yards, but it has been Palco's night.
Well, we said he had to play with poise. And early on, he was challenged after this fumble. How would he respond to that? Well, he kept his composure, comes back, finds Turner for a touchdown, and then comes back later, completes a pass to Kinder, and Kinder turns a short pass into a touchdown run. So it's been a pretty good night for Tyler Palco.
Second down and 9. Possible throwing down here with two tight ends. Palco back to throw. Lobbing one again. Putting it up. Seeing if his receiver can make a play. And it turns out that Marcel Pestano can do just that. Another big first down for Pitt.
But here's the matchup, man-to-man coverage, press coverage. Who wins it? Well, you see Pestano wins that thing. He has a nice job of getting to the outside, and it was all about can the wide receivers beat the corners, and they can.
And, Rod, you talked about how Matt Kavanaugh, offensive coordinator, in the offseason talked with Palco about Joe Montana. One thing they said, if you throw short passes, your receivers can turn them into big plays. They've done that twice.
On first down again, Palco to the air. This time, it's batted down by a blitzing Dominic Ross. So Ross comes from the outside and gets the Palco pass. It'll be second down and 10.
But that's okay. This is what they were saying to them. It doesn't have to be perfect. If you just throw some short passes, your receivers will eventually break some tackles, just like Joe Montana and Steve Young did, turn them into long plays. If they bat the ball back, don't worry about it.
Well, they had guys in Rice and Solomon and Mike Wilson.
Nice play by Tony Carvetti coming through to trip up Shane Brooks at the line.
Well, we're seeing the effects of that coaching on Palco here. We saw him fumble the ball. We saw him be frustrated in the first half. He stuck with it. And Matt Kavanaugh's coaching of him to stay cool, stay calm. You don't have to be perfect. You can be excellent and still make mistakes if they're not the big mistake.
Well, that's the thing about Joe Montana. He played the next play. And the play that ended was over. He played the next play.
Well, speaking of the next play, a huge play for the Cincinnati defense here. Trying to keep it a two-score game and trying to get off the field. Palco with a tipped ball. Oh, they tried the inside screen to T.J. Porter, but Palco was hurried. The blitz came up the middle from Carvetti. Actually, from a defensive line standpoint, he runs a stunt. And now Cincinnati, they bend, but they do not break.
Number 53 in the center of your screen. He splits the pass protection and closes with the quarterback quickly. And then see Palco's head snap back and hit the ground. This man is 6 feet tall, just about 230 pounds. And he just split about 630 pounds of offensive line.
You keep making him lighter. You had him 235 before.
Well, it's the second half. He's lost a little water weight.
Wrestle launches one up into the air. Takes a bounce. inside the 10-yard line, out of bounds at about the 7. Trailing 14-0, Cincinnati will have it when we come back, but field position not their friend right now.
Sign up for a free 30-day trial, including calls and nonstop sports, and get a $150 signing bonus.
Saturday Night Football on ABC, Ohio State versus Texas, this Saturday at 8.
I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tie that binds. Because you're mine, I walk the line. Because you're mine, I walk the line.
From the man who brought fantasy to life comes a hair product born into reality. Fabio. Beauty has a face, perfection a name. Fabio. And now, you can experience a shampoo worthy of only one man's name.
Life comes at you fast. Are you ready for retirement? Get ready with Nationwide Investments Retirement Insurance.
Nationwide is on your side.
When you want to finish with truly healthy hair, where do you start? Right at the source, the scalp. Introducing the totally reinvented Head & Shoulders. The Hydra Zinc formula contains 6 times the moisturizers for your scalp and hair. It's healthy and beautiful. So eliminate up to 100% of visible flakes and start at the scalp for truly healthy hair. And now, take a rejuvenating escape with new Ocean Lift from Head & Shoulders.
Football Primetime, brought to you by Levi's, the original. Find your style at levisstore.com. And Nationwide, Nationwide is on your side.
A hot spot here in Cincinnati is Skyline Chili. Apparently Skyline made a delivery to our booth. Pittsburgh right now with a 14-0 lead, and the nothing that Cincinnati has on the board right now, Rod Gilmore, is about what you and I ended up with. As Moore goes for a couple of yards.
Yeah.
Now, I noticed that Trevor somehow found his way to the Skyline Chili buffet line.
Yeah, we didn't get any.
I got nothing.
You got it all.
Don't let me to the buffet first. I've been told that a secret ingredient in this is chocolate. And I don't know if that's true, but I'm just guessing it is, and that's why you guys got no chili.
I think you got my plate.
I got the chili.
You got my plate, didn't you?
Yum, yum.
As a fine connoisseur of media buffets all over the country, I can attest that Trevor was treated right now, and you and I were left out in the cold.
That looks pretty good, Trevor. Thanks for sharing.
Yum, yum. Yeah. I told you how good it was.
Second down and 10. Davila back to throw under pressure. Shovels one off, and that's an ineligible receiver. Chris Flores, the center, that makes the tackle. So Chris Flores at least heads up to catch the football, but I don't believe you're allowed to do that.
Well, if they rule that he dished that from the end zone, it'll be a penalty in the end zone and a safety.
That's exactly right.
And it may take replay to make that determination. Now, right now, the Pitt defense thinks they're going to get 2 points.
Yeah, check out where is he when he lets this ball go. 1 foot out.
Now he's back in. Two penalties on the play. Illegal touching on the offense. Their penalty is declined. Intentional grounding, number 9 on the offense. The pass took place in the end zone. Therefore, it is a safety.
You know what? Davila right now is frustrated, but it would have been a safety either way. He was in the grasp. and it would have been a safety anyway. He was just trying to make something happen.
To me, I think he still had enough time to try and at least throw the ball out of bounds over the head of someone. I mean, to me, again, I don't know if that's an instance of a quarterback coming in, as you said, Rod, cold off the bench and making a mental error that he may not have made if he had been playing the whole game. It's, I guess, tough to read his mind.
Well, I do think it's very tough. Now, you have to have some awareness of where you are on the field. You have to be aware that you are in the end zone. You have to get rid of the ball quickly.
Right.
And you're talking about an inexperienced quarterback, a junior college transfer, set out last year, played basically a half last week, and now he sits for the entire first half, and that's his fourth play of the game.
Let's go, Let's go.
You can hear on the sideline some of the players for Cincinnati saying there's a lot of football left, and they're certainly right. There's half of the third quarter and the entire fourth quarter to go, and technically it's still only a two-possession game, but you wonder, with the mistakes that Nick Davila has made, if at some point we're going to see Dustin Brusa again.
Well, I think if you have a two-quarterback system, and, you know, I've never advocated that, but if you have one, you have to give the young man a chance to prove he can play. I mean, you didn't play him in the first half when you normally would do a quarter-by-quarter switch, so give him a chance.
Lowell Robinson back deep to receive the free kick for Pitt. And good field position for the Panthers out to the 45-yard line. A reminder coming up, we will have our Friday night debate between Rod and Trevor, and tonight's topic will be poll gate. Jim Tressel with a slip of the tongue that conflicted with what some of the information coming out of his own university was regarding his vote. Did he vote for his own team? Well, USA Today says he did after he claimed that he voted for Texas as number one in the polls. Should there even be a coach's poll? And this kind of brings that issue to the fore, and that's something we'll be debating with Rod and Trevor coming up in just a little bit. 16-0 Pitt now with the lead and the ball. Ed Palko looking for more. He wants it all. The catch made again by Kinder, and he will waltz into the end zone for a touchdown. Another huge play by the Pitt offense.
And this is a great throw by Palko. He knows that his receiver, Kinder, is in a better position to see an underthrown ball and come back to it. Man-to-man press coverage outside.
Pass interference, number 33 on the defense. Penalty is declined. Touchdown.
A frustrating night for a defensive coordinator that at one point coached a defense to a national championship. Now as a head coach, sees big plays made against his own defense.
Well, you know, now that you see that replay, how about pass interference the other way?
That's what
Kinder,
I thought.
With his right hand, pushed Mickens out of the way to come back for that ball.
Somehow the extra point is made by Connor Lee. The snap was a bad one, but they got it down, and somehow Connor Lee muscled it over. A 23-0 lead now for Pitt.
Bust the blandness with fiery buffalo boneless wings at KFC. Get 100% breast meat boneless wings dipped in our fiery buffalo sauce. Try 6 for $2.99 or 18 for $8.79. Also available in honey barbecue flavor. No bones, all flavor at KFC.
Welcome to Lowe's. May I help you?
Yes. We have this kitchen. We'd love to have this kitchen.
Let me show you some options.
Okay, let's get started.
At Lowe's, our kitchen specialists can help you build a kitchen you've always dreamed of. We'll walk you through every step, even installation, with your budget in mind. When you come to Lowe's, you'll find more than a salesperson. You'll find a partner. Lowe's, let's build something together.
Use your Lowe's card and pay nothing for 12 months on any kitchen cabinets or countertops purchase of $299 or more.
Germs in your mouth. The problem is, they keep coming back. You need a toothpaste that keeps on fighting. Colgate Total, the only toothpaste clinically proven to fight germs for a full 12 hours.
Tuesday, the last two quarterfinal matches. An all-new contender doubleheader. Tuesday, 10 p.m. Eastern on ESPN.
The Optimum Double Play. Only for our cable TV customers. Optimum Online and Optimum Voice. Each just $29.95 a month for a year when you get both together. Optimum Online. Faster and more reliable than DSL. Optimum Voice. Unlimited flat rate calling in the U.S., Canada, and Puerto Rico. Two great Optimum services for less than you probably spend on your phone service alone. Total savings, $240. For the best deal in town, it's Optimum or it's not.
Sign up on the web today and get this free gift.
Find movie ratings helpful?
Parents find this rating system very useful in helping them guide their children's viewing.
Or harmful?
Violence is fine, sex isn't.
The studio won't release your movie if it has an NC-17.
If you love movies,
who is controlling this thing?
No one knows. That's the whole point.
You have to find out who's really calling the shots in Hollywood.
We're hiring a private investigator to try to find out who these people are.
Got a raider.
Do you ever do interviews at all?
No.
This film is not yet rated. Only in theaters this September.
Sideline conversation between Tyler Palko and Derek Kinder might have gone something like, wow, you know, Derek, you just got away with one. Hey, you know what, Tyler? You're right. As we take another look at the touchdown, Pittsburgh with a 23-0 lead. We'll take a look in a moment. A very debatable flag was thrown. And I think both Trevor Maddich and Rod Gilmore feel it was thrown against the wrong player. Goodman will take from the goal line for Cincinnati. And they trail now by 23 points. Here's the touchdown.
Yeah, this is as bad a call as you'll ever see, or non-call. This is offensive pass interference, and it doesn't get called at all. Watch the right hand and the push-off here by Kinder. Right there, throws him out of the way, and then grabs the ball. Now, guys, everybody talks about how great instant replay is. If the purpose of instant replay is to get it right, then it doesn't work, because that is an important play, and you can't use instant replay, and it's 7 points the wrong way.
Now, that's not a reviewable call, though. That's a
just it should be.
Call.
It's as important as any other possession.
Don't you think then you're opening up a Pandora's box, though, where you can replay judgment calls made by officials on the field? That's a judgment call.
If you want to get it right, if you're trying to get calls right, if you're trying to get them right, that's as important a play as any other play in the ballgame.
It is, though. I guess where you draw the line in terms of reviewing judgment calls by officials. Trevor, if you want to weigh in on that.
Well, I agree with both of you. It was a terrible call, but that's a Pandora's box that shouldn't be open.
So far, the touchdown drives tonight by Pitt. Two plays, one play, one play. Davila over the middle to Gladauer, and he picks up about seven.
Yeah, Rob, because then, and I would ask you this, that obviously would have been overturned had there been replay on that judgment call. Well, but what if a flag is not thrown for holding on that play, and then there's a coach's challenge, hey, I think the left tackle held, and it was a touchdown.
My point is simple. We're making those judgments all the time. The judgment is made, oh, we're only going to include these types of calls. Well, that's a judgment. You can include pass interference. I mean, pass interference has as big an impact on a ball game as any other call during a game.
Second down and three. And now flags fly. It will be delay of game.
Number nine on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Remains second down.
It's just that now the plays that are reviewed by instant replay are black and white plays. Was it a score? Was it not? Was he inbounds? Was he not? Was the ball coming out before he hit the ground or not? And you are bringing now into the argument whether or not an official thinks it could have been pass interference or not. And that extends to a lot of different judgment calls.
Bob, all I'm saying is that instant replay is not a panacea if you say it's to get it right, because that's wrong.
To the near side, Ernest Jackson, dragged down at the 32. About 2 yards shy of the first down. Sam Bryant made the stop for Pitt, and now a must conversion. You would have to think, with 6.5 minutes to go in the third quarter for Cincinnati, they just need a drive and a few first downs to take place.
Well, they need to find Selleck. I mean, they got to get him back involved in the ballgame. And he's their best go-to receiver, and they haven't found him in a long time.
To the near side. They get the ball to one of their tight ends. It's not Selleck. It's Doug Jones, who came out of the backfield, and he converts, and it's a first down for Cincinnati.
Selleck did help, though. He got out ahead of Jones. Now watch number 85. He's right in the middle of the screen there. Now, he doesn't get the ball, but watch him do a little roller derby right here. Kind of do a Heine block.
A Heine
on
HB block?
Blades. Well, that's because we're a family show.
What's a Heine block?
I would love to see the football handbook where that's explained. On an end around, Goodman looking to throw, has nowhere to go, and is dragged down. He is ruled down by contact, but the speed again of Tommy Campbell knocks Goodman down for about a 9-yard loss.
Well, you know what speed does? Speed allows you to make big plays. And this is a big play because it's a loss for Cincinnati. Campbell from the backside runs this play down.
Well, he was looking for Ernest Jackson, number 14, the wide receiver, the only receiver to go out on that play. And he was covered tightly. That's why he had to pull it down. He couldn't throw it. And right now, Mark Antonio was thinking, for goodness sake, nothing I'm calling is working.
Paul Rose, the defensive coordinator for Pitt, loves Tommy Campbell. Downfield goes Davila, and it's incomplete. The intended receiver was Derek Stewart. That sets up third down and 19. Darrell Revis, who you get a good look at there. A freshman All-American in 2004. A first-team All-Big East selection last year. Paul Rhodes, the defensive coordinator, he is as good as any cornerback in the country and any cornerback he has coached. He will play as a first-round pick next year in the NFL. And he tries to come up and make the stop here. Can't do it. Out of bounds on the near side is Gladauer, but way short of a first down. So again, our Friday night debate is coming up between Trevor and Rod Gilmore. And again, we're going to talk about whether or not, in the wake of the Jim Tressel controversy, did he vote for Texas? Did he vote for Ohio State? Should there even be a coach's poll? And guys, I know you're both going to weigh in on this, and I'm interested to see what you both think.
You mean we didn't debate already?
This will be the official debate. Revis from the 16, fumbles the ball, and Cincinnati has it, and maybe a chance for the Bearcats to get back in the game. And once again, we'll have to hold off on the debate for a moment because Cincinnati now gets a huge break, and maybe the Bearcats have some life breathed into them.
Revis, who's been such an outstanding punt returner, drops the second one of the night. This one just goes right through him. And he's usually pretty sure-handed, except for tonight. First quarter, he dropped one, recovered it himself. This one, he's not so lucky.
D'Angelo Smith made the recovery for Cincinnati. So now it's first and 10 for the Bearcats at the 17-yard line. And this is an absolute must for Cincinnati, and they have gone back to Dustin Grootsa at quarterback. So the starter tonight back in the game in the red zone under some pressure and barely gets back to the line. Maybe he gained a yard, brought down by Chris McKillop.
And you go back to Grootsa right now over Davila just because of game management. When Davila was in there, it didn't work out well. Now here's Revis. Watch his feet. His feet aren't set and under the ball. That's the first quarter drop. Now watch his feet again on the second drop. They're going to be sort of together when the ball comes down and one foot is off the ground. You catch punch with your feet. They've got to be set shoulder width.
Second down and 9. To the near side, the catch made by Goodman. Powers his way down to about the 6-yard line. That should be good for a first down. It'll be first and goal for Cincinnati.
Now, Grootsa does a nice job on a quick three-step getting this ball out to Goodman so he has an opportunity to run with the ball after the catch. And he picks up a first down. I think that two-quarterback experiment is probably over with Cincinnati, at least tonight.
At least tonight.
Out of the shotgun, Grootsa on first down and goal to go. All the time in the world. Trying to buy some time. Tucks it under. Gets to the chalk. Is he in? Touchdown. A late call from the official coming in from the sideline. But Dustin Grootsa scrambles for Cincinnati's first points tonight. And Darrell Revis turns out to cost his team seven.
Now this is going to be a close one. Watch Grootsa at the end. Does he get into the end zone?
On the prior play.
Where is the ball? Where is his knee? Was his knee down? Hard to tell from that angle. He stretched it all the way out.
I think he was down.
He was a good distance away, but he was laying out. If the knee was down, then he's not in. There's a different look. There's his knee right there.
And then he stretches the ball out.
But from that angle, it's not definitive. This one will be better. Knee down.
Yep,
that ball should be on the one.
Yep.
Still, though, great moxie on the part of Grootsa. He's not a fast guy. He is slippery, and it's hard to get a clean shot at him. That's why he was able to fall forward even there at the goal line.
Well, the officials reviewing the play, and it certainly seems obvious that it will be Cincinnati's ball on the one-yard line, second down and goal.
The reason you see two officials here, the referee with the white hat is talking to the replay official. The other official there is the one who made the call. Those are the two officials talking to the replay booth.
Okay,
after
again,
review, there's indisputable video evidence that the runner's knee was down before the ball broke the play to the goal line. The ball will be placed at the one-yard line, second and goal.
Well, so far tonight, you have to say that every time we have gone to the replay booth for a call that is reviewable, the officials have gotten the call right.
I think Rod loves replay, and he wants the whole game to be replayed, every decision.
It is. Every play is reviewed in the booth.
No, that's not what I mean. You turn that around on.
Butler Benton is the tailback. Instead, it's the upback, Marcus Wall. And he can't find the end zone. It'll be third down and goal from just inside the one. HB Blades led the charge for Pitt and lost his helmet in the process.
Yeah, guys, this is a two-play situation. They got to have a touchdown to stay in the ballgame or to get in the ballgame. So you call your play. There's your offensive coordinator right there. There's Don Treadwell. He's already thinking about the next play if they don't get in here. And this play should lead to the next play if they don't make it.
McKenzie in motion. This time over the top goes Gladauer for the touchdown. So it took a little longer than Cincinnati might have hoped, but Dave Wannstedt sees his team turn it over on special teams. For Cincinnati's first score now, they convert.
This is their biggest back. He's the one that is the hard charger, and he does get carried back by Bryant and that defense, but not before his momentum carries him over.
All you need is for the football to break the plane, and it did.
Lovell on for the extra point, and it's good. 2:41 to go in the third quarter of a game that is far from over. And it's now 23-7. Although, again, we do have a Friday night debate to get to. And while we have a moment, before Pitt takes back over, guys, your thoughts on, in the wake of the Jim Tressel scandal, I guess you could say. It's probably not that big of a deal at the end of the day. But should there even be a coach's poll? Should the college football coaches be the ones determining who ranks where?
Okay, I'll lead off on this one. I think that college coaches should be involved and should be voting. I don't buy the argument that they don't have time. I think these coaches see enough tape. They see enough highlights. They actually see enough games. This is their profession. They see what's going on out there. They have an idea who's good, and they should be voting. The one caveat is that I'm not crazy about coaches voting on their own team. I think that that's something that should be taken out because it's really a conflict of interest, and it's better not to have coaches vote on their own team in a poll. How do you feel?
That's the only caveat? I think coaches should not, for two reasons. One, I think they know their own team and the team they're playing. But if they have time to look around at all the other teams that intimately, I think the administrator would be angry with them. So I think, first of all, they don't see as much. But even more than that, you've got something even more important, which I'll talk about after this play.
The kickoff, a line drive. And it is more than returnable. as heading to the outside is Lowell Robinson. Robinson out to the 45-yard line. But again, to continue the conversation, is there an ethical boundary in terms of coaches having, obviously, their own selfish interests when they vote these polls?
Well, let me address that and hit another point. The first one is that if you have integrity involved, and that, as presumably all these coaches have a lot of integrity, you don't worry about that. The only clear conflict of interest is when they vote on their own team. Now, they may be interested in voting for a friend or their conference, but that's not a clear conflict. And secondly, Trevor, I would ask you, if coaches don't have time, what did D'Antoni tell us he was going to be doing tomorrow night? He's going to watch the Ohio State-Texas game. So coaches do watch other teams. They have time to watch other games.
He's playing on Friday.
Yeah?
Okay.
And their games on Thursday? And their games during the week? And their night games after your game?
Okay, well, I'll say my point.
Nice tackle by Trevor Anderson, ranging sideline to sideline to bring down the freshman Kevin Collier.
See, I don't think there's an ethical problem, but I think there is an appearance of an ethical problem. If you want to have a BCS team at large from your conference, that means lots of dollars in your pocket. Is that conference more likely to vote for a team from their conference rather than a different conference? At the same time, maybe you don't want a rival in the conference to tell recruits they're going to the BCS, and so you wouldn't vote for them when maybe they're deserving. Now, there's an appearance there of self-interest and politics.
No money goes into the pocket of the coach, though. Maybe to the school, but not to the coach.
Yeah, but the school.
Collier lost a yard. Again, Trevor Anderson coming up to make the stop. So, do you think in any way Jim Tressel now being involved in this controversy affects the game tomorrow night?
I really don't think so. I mean, what's the downside for him? If he was trying to fire up his players don't care because he's telling them all the time he thinks they're great. And it certainly isn't going to affect Texas because he was saying out there, oh, Texas, I think you're number one, and had a plausible excuse for it. I don't think it has any impact on the game at all.
Then why did he do it?
He said it was a mistake. You don't believe him?
Uh-huh.
Third down and 11. Play clock was winding down. Palco stumbles coming away and off balance, unable to hit a wide open Shane Brooks. So all of a sudden, Cincinnati is starting to take some momentum back, trailing 23-7, but they scored a touchdown and they have now forced Pitt into a punting situation.
We take a look at Mark D'Antonio. He's a very serious coach, even grim sometimes. He doesn't mess around, and he won't let the emotions of his team get out of control. He will wrestle them where he wants it. Right now, he wants it in comeback mode.
Stewart deep to receive. A wobbly kick. This one is returnable, and Stewart has a lane to the outside. Can he turn the corner? A flag flies. Stewart, only the punter to beat. And he gets tracked down from behind at the 25-yard line. But there are two flags all the way back at the Cincinnati 30. Well, the crowd here at Nippert Stadium thinks their special teams just made a big play. But momentum about to shift yet again as this one will come back.
It looked like an illegal block in the back. Whether they called it or not, it did occur.
I would say there's a good chance they called it. I see two flags down.
How about three flags? One at the 45 and a pair at the 30.
And there's a bunch of Pitt players standing around the 40-yard line. Believe me, they're tired enough that if they didn't know this was the call, they'd have walked down to the other end of the field.
That return was good for 57 yards, but depending on where they rule the block in the back took place, if it comes back and then some, it could be about a 65-yard penalty after all is said and done. And now the officials are coming over to talk to the Cincinnati sideline.
Now, Rod, this is not a reviewable play, but if it's called back, it would be an impact on the game.
Sure.
A big one.
And if
do
it's
you
wrong.
Think this should be
if,
reviewable?
If it's wrong. We've passed that one. Let's just move on.
Now, Mark D'Antonio is receiving an explanation, and obviously I'm hoping that we're about to get whatever explanation that Mark D'Antonio just got, because there are three flags down on the play in two different locations. Inside of the final minute of the third quarter, and this is a huge call in terms of field position, and it also might kill a little bit of the momentum that Cincinnati has built.
This is a lengthy delay.
There are offsetting penalties on the play. Illegal block in the back on Cincinnati. Face mask on Pittsburgh. The penalties will offset. Replay fourth down.
Well, that's a win for Pitt. In a manner of speaking, if you had no penalties, that ball would be in Cincy territory.
Block in the back right there.
And, of course, the face mask is at the end of the play here on the tackle. Right there.
So now, once again, an opportunity for Stewart. Again, a wobbly kick. Again, returnable. Can he get to the outside on the near side? And no, he is tracked down after a return of about 5 yards. Clint Session came down and made the stop. So now, should the coaches poll be discontinued, you can log on to ESPN.com to vote. And as of right now, 57% of you think, and I guess agree with Rod, that the coaches should be involved in determining who is at the top of the polls.
Well, they don't necessarily agree with me or my reasoning. They may simply like the poll. They want to keep the poll.
57% of the people out there voted the way you can. You at least, are you going to disagree with the people who are agreeing with you?
I'm trying to be humble because next week they'll be voting against me.
Grootsa back in at quarterback, and he goes play action. Tucks it under and picks up about 7 yards. Tripped up by Clint Session. And that will take us to the end of the third quarter. The fourth quarter of a game that right now is being led 23-7 by Pitt, but could be turning Cincinnati's way somewhat.
The ESPN.com Fantasy Football Guide on newsstands now.
Your ultimate drink stop. Drive in for Sonic's new Peach Fruit Smoothie. A delicious, fat-free combination of real peaches and creamy yogurt blended to perfection. Sonic's new Peach Fruit Smoothie. It's not just good, it's Sonic good.
T-Mobile's family plan takes on the competition. Which plan holds up to the biggest talkers? Let's find out.
What's up, Dad? Dude, I have no idea where I am.
You got more minutes.
Onions, pepperoni. You want pizza, Dad?
Get off that phone.
Dude, that's awesome.
Stop. Overage.
Introducing T-Mobile's back-to-school family time plan. 1,000 minutes, just $49.99.
T-Mobile, get more minutes.
Why did I join the Army Reserve? It's not just for the experience or the training I can use as a soldier and as a civilian. It's for them, for my country. It's all worth fighting for. And the Army Reserve gave me the strength it takes.
Visit GoArmyReserve.com.
Need new tires? Get to the big Bridgestone rebate event for up to a $100 mail-in rebate on select Bridgestone Dueler tires, September 7th through October 7th. Only at your local participating Bridgestone and Firestone retailer. Wherever you see this Bridgestone sign.
They are the kings and queens, the potentates of the road. We recognize them by their restless wing-tipped feet. We support them with new thicker mattresses and lay the freshest fine white linens at their feet, an offering of respect. Our beds, ourselves, courtyards changed it all for them. Rest well, my liege. Rest well.
Your ultimate drink stop. Drive in for Sonic's new Peach Fruit Smoothie. A delicious, fat-free combination of real peaches and creamy yogurt blended to perfection. Sonic's new Peach Fruit Smoothie. It's not just good, it's Sonic good.
They watch.
Set for the start of the fourth quarter, and all of a sudden the fans here in Cincinnati and a lot of young ones on fan tonight with something to cheer about. They trail 23-7. It's a 16-point game, so obviously with the two-point conversion being potentially brought in, it's still a two-possession game. They have been dominated in terms of total yards tonight, but the Bearcats have the football back just shy of midfield. Second down and four to start the fourth quarter. They scored a touchdown on their last possession. Gladauer breaks a tackle, flags down at the line. He has the first down if the play stands. Mike Phillips made the stop along with Joe Clermont.
You talk about the game management of these two quarterbacks. Grootsa using a hard count to draw the defense what looks like to be offsides.
And that is the call. By declining the penalty, Cincinnati will pick up an extra yard.
Offsides, number 93 on the defense. Penalty is declined. Result of the play, first down.
And a six-yard gain for Bradley Gladauer.
And Trevor, you have to ask the question, where is Brent Celek? He's the tight end. He's a big part of the offense, but he's been very quiet tonight.
And he is at the top of your screen. He is the down tight end in the three-point stance. Out in a pass pattern here, but there will be no chance for Dustin Grootsa to even look for him. Rashad Duncan comes up the middle and gets the sack.
Grootsa was looking for Celek. He was staring him down. Watch him. He's staring down his tight end, Celek, and doesn't feel the pressure coming from Duncan.
And he had Grootsa. He ran a crossing route right in front of safety Sam Bryant. It was there.
Rashad Duncan played in every game last year for Pitt as a true freshman, now as a sophomore, making a big impact. Gladauer on the inside handoff, runs right in to H.B. Blades, the first team All-Big East selection. As we check our game track for tonight, with 1 minute gone by on the fourth, Tyler Palko with three touchdown passes, 267 yards all in all. That was a big non-call, though. Derek Kinder went the distance on what looked like an offensive pass interference call. The fumble by Rivas on the punt of leads to the Cincinnati touchdown, their only points so far tonight. So Cincinnati trying to hang in the game, facing third down and 11. Here comes the blitz, and again, Grootsa running for his life, and short hops it to the near side. As Doug Fulmer was providing pressure, it will be fourth down.
Well, they brought the pressure from the top side of the field, the wide side of the field, forcing Grootsa to throw the ball quickly. And again, that kind of pressure is designed to make the quarterback throw it fast so the defense can tackle right away.
And Rod, they showed the pressure. They showed it so that Grootsa would be aware of it and worried about it even before the play started.
Steele gets away the punt, a wobbly kick. Rivas calls for a fair catch, and this time very sure about his foot position and ball security as we check downstairs with Rob Simulcare. Rob?
All right, Bob. Well, we're actually standing in the fifth oldest stadium in Division I football. This Nippert Stadium has been around for quite a long time. It's got a lot of tradition, but they're trying to update it as well. They just spent $105 million on this facility behind me. You might be able to see. It is a varsity village. It's called Richard Linder Varsity Village, and we walked through there yesterday. Quite an impressive facility. They've got brand new training rooms, video rooms, weight rooms in there. They also have a new baseball stadium they put in there, classrooms, offices. Very good facility, and you know, something that's going to bring this program hopefully into the next century. Back up to you, Bob.
A nice run by Shane Brooks for about 9 yards, but Rob's exactly right. They put about $115 million into their new athletic facility here in Cincinnati. So they have all the facilities necessary when they built that building to have a top-flight program.
And it is gorgeous inside. It's on par with any facility in the country. And there are only two colleges in a BCS conference in the state of Ohio State and Cincinnati. 65 BCS conference scholarships out of Ohio last year. They can't all go to Ohio State. They're trying to get him here.
Brooks again trying to turn the corner and gets to the outside and gets out to the 45-yard line. Finally forced out by John Bowie, but a big gain for Shane Brooks and a Pitt first down.
Well, we've talked about the wide receivers of Pitt making big plays in the passing game. Well, they're doing a nice job blocking as well. You don't get runs like that unless your wide receivers like Kinder and Turner make blocks downfield.
Well, Derek Turner has a touchdown catch tonight, but Derek Kinder, number 81, you see coming right at you. He has 172 yards and two touchdowns tonight on three touches. Every time he's touched the ball, it's been a big play. Nice stop and readjust at the line by Brooks. Cuts it to the right, picks up about 6 yards.
This is Dave wants that mentality, smash mouth. You've got the lead, run it right at him. And you notice, too, that the helmet says Pitt. They used to say Pittsburgh until Wanstead got there. Pittsburgh, as in, don't call me Pitt. But it was called Pitt when they won the national championship. And Wanstead wants to bridge back to those glory years.
You know, that's right. For a long time, they would put in their media notes, don't call us Pitt. Now they want to be Pitt.
Well, they were Pitt when Dave Wanstead was a player there as well. Conridge Collins dragged down in the backfield by Terrell Byrd, who gets up, celebrates, and mugs for the camera, down 23-7, which is something I never totally understood.
Leave him alone. He's enjoying the game. He's excited. He's having fun.
He just got his tonsils out. He's probably thrilled that he can eat solid food.
If I'm Mark D'Antonio, I'm not sure if I want to hear that my guy is enjoying being down 23-7.
He's playing hard.
Oh, I don't doubt the effort on the play. It's the post-game, post-play histrionics. Third down and 9. Palco, delayed handoff. Some room for Brooks, but he is dragged down right at the line. Nice play by Kevin McCullough coming up to make the stop, and Pitt will be forced to punt it away with 10:50 to go.
Brooks is getting some valuable experience tonight with Lerod Stevens howling out of the ballgame with an ankle injury. They're going to need Brooks as the season moves along. These running backs are young. They need some time. They got to learn how to make a guy miss so that they can really help the Pitt offense.
Derek Stewart is a dangerous return man. This one not returnable, though, as it bounces inside the 15-yard line. It takes a beautiful Pitt roll. Somehow stays in bounds and a slow roll down to about the 10-yard line. Does the Cincinnati offense have one last gasp in them? They have the football when we come back.
You've always been competitive. That's why you choose GNC's Mega Men Sport Multivitamin. It's balanced nutrition and energy support for optimal health and athletic performance. Plus, it's enhanced with antioxidants, prostate, and heart support. At GNC, we believe a quality life starts from within. Live well.
To the people, he was a hero.
Your will is my strength.
To those in power,
it's always a price for everything we do.
I'm not framing it.
He was a threat.
What are you doing for that man?
Whatever it is, don't.
Inspired by true events, Academy Award winner Sean Penn, Academy Award nominees Jude Law and Kate Winslet, and Academy Award winner Anthony Hopkins.
No man has ever been able to intimidate me.
In the motion picture event of the fall, All the King's Men, rated PG-13. In theaters everywhere, September 22nd.
You've waited, you've dreamed, and now it's finally back. Endless shrimp at Red Lobster, the only time of year to enjoy all the irresistible shrimp you can eat. Don't miss Endless Shrimp right now, only at Red Lobster.
Attention, concerned parents. Does your son like pretty girls? Does he have an upper body or torso? Does he ever wear pants with pockets? If you answered yes to any of these, then your son may already be using new Tag body shots. Consider yourself warned.
Time for something new from eBay.
eBay Express is the new place to find new items you can buy right away. From new cashmere sweaters to new golf clubs, eBay Express, where you'll always find it new.
Get it new, buy it now. eBayExpress.com.
Pitt has the lead. Cincinnati has the football back as we return to Cincinnati. Bob Schusen, Rod Gilmore, Trevor Maddich, and Rob Simulcare with you. ESPN's college football primetime on a Friday night with about 5 minutes gone by in the fourth quarter. And Cincinnati needs a touchdown drive in the worst way. Fumble of the football, though, and they turn it over. Greg Moore stripped at the 22-yard line. So the junior lost the football. And H.B. Blades comes up with the recovery.
Cincinnati fumble recovered by number 51, H.B. Blades.
the son of Benny Blades, who, of course, not only played for the Detroit Lions and Seattle Seahawks, but was also coached by Dave Wannstedt when Wannstedt was the defensive coordinator for Jimmy Johnson at the University of Miami.
Oh, watch the play here as the ball is stripped. It looks like, is that Campbell who was in there? Yeah, 29 Campbell. And Blades gets on it, but Campbell was the guy who caused the strip.
Turner in motion to the ground, and Shane Brooks. A 2-yard gain. Tackle made by Trevor Anderson. So Moore, I'm sure, dejected on the sideline, as that might put this football game away for Pitt.
Well, if you're Cincinnati defensively, you're thinking about taking the ball away. You have to respond if you're going to give your team a chance. You can't afford to give up another score here.
Again, it's Brooks. A crease to the 20. Dragged down at the 16-yard line. That might be face masking. Two penalty flags were thrown. John Bowie made the stop, but it looked like Brooks was pulled down by the face mask.
Yeah, watch the very end of the play. And when Bowie comes in, 33, does he get the face mask? Yep, right there. And then he doesn't let go. He turns the head. And when you turn the head, that ought to make it a flagrant one.
Personal foul, face mask, number 42 on the defense. Penalty will be half the distance to the goal from the end of the play. First down.
Yeah, you're right, Rod. This Coach D'Antonio upset about that. But he was just trying to make a play. It didn't look to me like that was a frustration play. It looked to me like he was just trying to make a tackle. And even though it was called a flagrant face mask, I don't think the intent was flagrant.
Well, then you let go of the face mask, and it's only a 5-yarder.
Sets up first and goal for the Panthers. Brooks stood up at the line. No gain on first down.
And once again, 6 foot tall, 235-pound Tony Carvitti gets the penetration and makes the tackle. This Cincinnati defense really has played a good game today. The score looks bad because they gave up two long touchdown passes, but they've done well.
And now Carvitti might be cramping up or holding his hamstring. Looks like a cramp. He's an interesting story, though. He's a walk-on that finally earned a scholarship last season, played 2 years as a walk-on player here at Cincinnati. Now he's in his senior season, and he was happy because that meant that he was finally able to quit the 20-hour-a-week job he had at Walgreens that he needed to help pay his way here for the Bearcats. Now he's a full scholarship player, and he has become a three-technique defensive tackle that they never really anticipated would ever play that position for them.
Well, think how tough it's been for him, because he walked on and had to convince the prior staff, where Rick Mentor was the head coach, that he deserved to be on the team and deserved a scholarship. And then he had to do it all over again when D'Antonio came in.
And you mentioned the job at Walgreens. He wants to be a pharmacist. This is a kid who gets by on his smarts, not on overwhelming athletic ability. And he got a job where he needs to be.
Second down and goal for Pitt. Palco has thrown three touchdown passes in the game, looking for number four. And he throws a field goal instead, fired it right between the uprights.
You see that? He's out there telling everybody, relax, relax. And did you see what his head coach said? He said, okay, way to think, way to think. Play the next play. Come back and play the next play.
What did Matt Kavanaugh tell us? That when you try to be perfect, all you do is set yourself up for frustration? And that's basically the message he delivered to Tyler Palco. If you hold yourself to too high a standard, you'll never be satisfied with your play.
Good for us, we're mired in mediocrity.
And I'm glad to be right there with you. Third down and goal. Palco, quarterback draw going nowhere. Right up the middle came Haruki Nakamura, who was the leading tackler for Cincinnati last year, to bring him down. It'll be fourth down, and the turnover will result in a field goal attempt.
That's another smart play by Palco, because he could have tried to make something out of that. He would have been hit by six guys if he did. and expose himself to stripping the ball.
30-yard field goal attempts for Connor Lee, who is now a sophomore, a walk-on, the new starter, because the senior David Abdul out for the season after undergoing heart surgery. And Connor Lee has been perfect so far tonight. 26-7, Pitt on top as we are midway through the fourth.
You don't know.
Now there's a new frascata at Wendy's, the new frascata italiana. Like all genuine Italian sandwiches, it's served on freshly baked artisan bread, topped with real Genoa salami, lean ham, natural Swiss, roasted peppers, and sun-dried tomato vinaigrette. For an Italian original, go to Wendy's and do what tastes right.
Your car, truck, or motorcycle can be a nightmare. But with Big Bucks Auto, it's easy.
Call 888-44-BUCKS.
Or go to BigBucksAuto.com.
Drive in for your free cash appraisal, and we'll buy your car within 20 minutes.
Even if it's leased or financed.
We do all the paperwork. It's simple.
No costly ads or psychos coming to your home. No bait and switch trade-ins, and not knowing what you're really getting for your car.
Don't sell or trade your vehicle until you call Big Bucks Auto. 888-44-BUCKS.
Flexible work schedule, competitive salary, growth opportunities, lifelong medical coverage, pension after just 20 years of service, and the satisfaction of being a New York City firefighter. It's the best job in the world. To get the best, take the test. Call now to register. Dial 311 and ask about the FDNY entrance exam, or go to nyc.gov/FDNY.
One versus two. Buckeyes, Longhorns. So much at stake, so early in the season. 8 p.m. Eastern in prime time. ESPN on ABC. It's Ohio State and Texas on Saturday Night Football.
Well, we're in Cincinnati, Ohio, but that guy better be careful. He faces possible deportation. Somehow a Longhorn fan has infiltrated Ohio, but the Buckeyes have fans everywhere throughout this state, even here in Cincinnati.
Everything's bigger in Texas.
Well, I have the good fortune of going to hang out with the good folks at ESPN.com tomorrow in Texas at that game for some online commentary and analysis during the game.
Stewart from the one. Tries to turn the corner and gets shut down at the 21-yard line. Now, this game is the Big East opener for both of these teams tonight. So it looks as if Pitt is going to start off the year at 1-0. Rod, this season for you, West Virginia, Louisville, Pitt, and Rutgers all factoring in. And Trevor, well, you like basically the same group and in a different order.
Well, I think Pittsburgh is going to be a factor. Looking at their team speed, I think they're a little different team than they had last year. West Virginia was the class of the conference initially for me. And then with Louisville losing Bush, I still think West Virginia is the class.
Grutza finds Benton out of the backfield. That's good for a first down. Now Louisville, though, dealing with life without Michael Bush.
They will, and they'll have to do some creative play calling to platoon their other running backs, which they can. But I think Pitt, because of their young talent, because of their great recruiting class this year, is going to be a real player for the championship in the next several years.
Flags down as Grutza scrambles and runs out at the 39-yard line. And Pitt could provide the ultimate spoiler role at the end of the season for either West Virginia or Louisville. If we take a look at the Pitt schedule after the penalty.
Illegal shift on the offense. All the players were not set for 1 second. 5-yard penalty, repeat first down.
Pitt's schedule will spend the entire season ramping up to those last two games against West Virginia and Louisville.
Yeah, you take a look at, you're talking about the West Virginia and Louisville games right down here at the bottom. But hey, do not sleep on Rutgers. State University of New Jersey looking like a bowl team already.
And of course, next week, Pitt has to get past Michigan State. But if they are able to win their games throughout the regular season, they could be looking not only to be a spoiler, but to be very much in contention with West Virginia and Louisville at the end of the year.
I think you're still sleeping on Rutgers, huh?
That catch made and good for a first down. Bill Poland with 6:24 to go stops the clock.
Well, we've seen a different style of play from Pitt this year than last. Much faster, much more attitude, much nastier, which is what Dave wants them wants. And when you look at this freshman recruiting class.
Ruta again to the outside as Pitt's defense is more than happy to exchange yardage for time. Ernest Jackson makes the catch.
This Pitt recruiting class, you've got 11 All-State high school players from Pennsylvania, 2 All-State from Ohio, 2 All-State from Florida, the New York State Defensive Player of the Year. They're going to be ready in a few years.
Ruta again swings it out. Benton makes the catch inbounds and picks up a couple of yards as once again we check in with Rob Simulcare.
A lot of people don't know this program has a lot of great history, a lot of national championships. So he took his players out over the course of the winter, took them around to some interesting sites around Pittsburgh, had them running up hills and up the stairs of famous buildings to connect them with that city and let them know, hey, you mean a lot in this city. This might be a Steelers town, but Pitt football means something, and try to get some pride and connection with that. It is the 30th anniversary of that 76 national championship team this year, too. So they got some guys from that team on opening night, and they're just trying to get these guys to feel proud and feel part of a real history and tradition at Pitt.
Brutza over the middle. Oh, and what a hit by Blades. And an unbelievable job of holding onto the ball by Dominic Goodman as Blades keeps a family tradition of heavy-hitting football very much alive. As that tradition comes from Miami to Pittsburgh, and Dave Wannstedt, the beneficiary. Out of bounds goes Stewart, but listen to this one.
How about Goodman, though? Goodman popped right up after that hit. Didn't hurt.
Oh, yeah, it hurt. All right. But Chris Spielman says that when you tackle, you should arrive with bad intentions. Those were bad intentions.
Third down and 3 with 5:11 remaining. Here comes the blitz. This time it's picked up by Cincinnati, but Goodman drops the ball. Check that Stewart. He had a chance to pick up the first down. The ball was slightly thrown behind him. You have to wonder if he was hearing those footsteps coming as Blades was in the area.
Well, when you go across the middle and you see a hit like that, the next time you or somebody else goes across, they remember who made the big hit.
Well, he thought he was past Blades. When the ball was behind him, he knew he had to slow down, and Blades was going to get there.
Fourth down and 3, and Cincinnati obviously compelled to go for it. With a little over 5 minutes remaining. Brutza buying time. Nice catch made by Dominic Goodman for a first down. And of course, Goodman a moment ago, shaking off the hit from Blades, bounces back with a first down catch.
Rod Grutza's making a case here for a one quarterback system. I like Davila, but Grutza right now has played his way into a lot of consideration.
Brutza tucks it under this time and scrambles for a first down to the 15-yard line.
Trevor, I think you're right about that. I think Brutza has a long ways to go, though. Blades is now down on the field.
Well, that's a weird angle on that leg. Number 51, middle of your screen.
Hard to tell.
Hard to tell if anything happened.
Oh.
Oh, cramp.
Yeah, cramp. Yeah. Yeah, he waited a moment, then the leg went out and he grabbed it. And when you get a cramp down there like that, I mean, you feel like somebody has just taken an ice pick and just shoved it in your calf. It really hurts.
Have you had a nice picture?
I think I probably did when I was 4 or 5 years old. That's why I kind of figured out that that's kind of what it was.
I tell you, it is so good for Pitt fans to see him limp off the field with what appears to be a grin.
Being the finely tuned athlete that I know you both realize I am, I know just how HB Blades felt. Those cramps are not fun. Usually when I'm quickly getting up to try and make sure I get the ice cream scoop before the commercial's over, sometimes you cramp up on your way back to the couch. Kruza looking end zone. Touchdown. Bill Polan makes the touchdown grab with 4:35 remaining. And now Cincinnati will most likely have to go for two. Certainly Dustin Kruza thinks it's time to go for two.
Yeah, it's a thing to do. You need points, you need scores, you're in the fourth quarter, you can cut it to a two-possession ball game if you can get the 2 points.
Yeah, drawing on what would be sort of the fantasy scenario for Cincinnati, you go for two and you cut it to 11, and then theoretically in 4.5 minutes to go, you're inside of a touchdown, a two-point conversion,
exactly,
and a field goal to tie.
Yep, two possessions.
Two-point conversion attempt for the Bearcats. Jackson in motion. A design rollout for Grutza. Wide open is Jackson. And the two-point conversion is perfect. So with 4:35 to go, Cincinnati has at least set themselves up to potentially author a miracle. A touchdown catch by Bill Polan makes it a two-possession game.
Stephen A. Smith here, tonight, quite frankly, the NFL season is underway, and my fantasy team's already in trouble. Plus, the human highlight film stops by right after college football on ESPN2.
ESPN Fantasy Football is free. Come play where the experts are, with coverage on TV, radio, online, in the magazine, and on mobile ESPN. We have all the tools and info you'll need to win. Play for free at ESPN.com.
Spending limit? Who cares?
Not us. Cause them ain't no credit cards.
Sure ain't.
Them motorcycles was expensive and fast.
And loud.
Oh yeah. Them bikes be like, wah.
No, like.
No, they went like, wah.
Sound good cause they free. Shoot. Yeah, shoot.
City Identity Theft Solutions. Talk to a real person to help get your life back. Free when you get a Citi credit card or Citibank account.
Heat. Enemy of engines. Enemy of heat? Pennzoil Platinum. It's the full synthetic with adaptive molecules that continually separate and reform to help conquer the scorching heat inside your engine. Not just oil, Pennzoil.
I got nothing.
Don't worry about it.
Cindy, I'm home.
Dad!
Warning, the makers of New Tag Wildcard remind you that if you mess with the King's Queens, you better watch your ace, Jack.
Introducing New Tag Wildcard. Consider yourself warned.
That's me, Evelyn. And it's my 7th day with Prilosec OTC. It started to work on my frequent heartburn on day 1. Zero heartburn for 24 hours with one pill a day. So what day are you on?
They're still having a good time here at Nippert Stadium as we welcome you to Cincinnati. In case you're just joining us on ESPN2 College Football Primetime, I'm Bob Wischusa with Rod Gilmore, Trevor Manich, and Rob Simulcare. And a moment ago, Bill Polan with a touchdown catch to kind of keep the game at least in doubt, quite frankly, with Stephen A. Smith, is coming up right after we're done here on ESPN2. And now Cincinnati is lining up for the onside kick attempt, 26-15. They trail Pitt, and they need the football back, trailing by 11 with 4:35 to go. The onside kick on the ground, and it is immediately covered up, and a flag is down as well. Nate Byam, backup tight end for Pitt, jumped on top of the football. But this is right at where the football was kicked from, so it might be offsides against Cincinnati.
Number 31 on the kicking team. The penalty will be enforced at the end of the play. First down.
Well, it's a nice fake there, but notice how the ball never pops up. It's sort of a drag kick. and they needed to beat Pitt to that kick because it was designed to be low and slow, and Pitt got there first.
And it turned out they got a head start to begin with.
Cincinnati, that is their first time out of the half.
And now on a change of possession, that stops the clock, or at least I take that back. A change of possession automatically moves the clock, so now you see Cincinnati spend a timeout to stop it.
Well, and that's the proper way to use the timeouts with the new clock rules. You need to stop the clock and maybe save one timeout for your offense.
Has nothing to do with your body.
Again, coming up on Monday night, a football doubleheader as Monday Night Football comes to ESPN as we check in now with Mike Tirico.
Monday night, Joe Gibbs and Washington begin their championship run against former Redskin Brad Johnson and the Vikings. Then Chargers star LaDainian Tomlinson visits Randy Moss and the Raiders. Vikings, Redskins, Chargers, Raiders, starting at 7 Eastern, a doubleheader season premiere of ESPN's Monday Night Football.
So that begins Monday night at 7 Eastern. And on Monday night, I think we're looking, out of those four teams, at one realistic Super Bowl contender. And I think that might be the San Diego Chargers. Although Joe Gibbs got his team to the playoffs last year, and some people are picking Minnesota to be a surprise team this year.
Before you write any teams off, can they play a game?
Okay.
All right.
Hand off to Shane Brooks. He picks up 2 yards. I'm just going to go over here now.
Hey, I'm just saying, people in Washington and Oakland, they have hope, they have dreams.
Cincinnati.
Don't they?
That is their second time out of the half.
So you're saying that there shouldn't be an NFL poll out until October either, is it?
Rob Simulcare is downstairs to show us what these two teams are playing for tonight.
All right, Bob. Well, some folks are walking in front of me right now, but this is the River City Rivalry Trophy. And, you know, the Big East is a fairly new conference. These teams had not played each other for 22 years before last year. They're trying to create a little rivalry here. So they created this, and it basically is a replica of a riverboat telegraph, which I'm sure you guys knew by looking at it. And it's got Pitt on one side, Cincinnati on the other. They're trying to get something going here. Of course, these two cities have a lot of rivalry. The Steelers and Bengals are huge rivals. The Pirates are actually in town tonight playing the Reds. So they're trying to drum something up. And, well, right now this trophy, the case that probably was holding it in Pittsburgh looks like it may be getting a return visit.
What I think will make this into a rivalry is when both of these teams start contending for the championship. And I think Pitt is just a few years away. Cincinnati has the pieces in place to do it. But right now, Pitt has got the players in place, the young players, that a year or two from now should compete.
Well, most of what you would consider the quote-unquote recruiting rating systems rated Pitt's recruiting class this past year to be a top 15 recruiting class in the country. And maybe the best to come to Pitt in about 15 years. Palco, miscommunication, the ball's on the ground, and Cincinnati picks it up. Running free is Bowie. And he's out of bounds inside the 30-yard line. It's a two-possession game with 4:15 to go, and a mistake on a broken play exchange between Palco and his running back, and who knows?
And you just don't expect this. You think you're salting the game away. And it's Palco, and he had the ball in the wrong hand, like he had it in his left hand, tried to get it to the right hand and get it over to Brooks, and kind of bobbled it, and then the handoff was bobbled as well.
Dave Wannstedt forced to sweat out a game that his team should have put away. Butler Benton in the backfield, Brutes out of a shotgun to the near side, makes connection. Knocked out of bounds is Dominic Goodman with a first down for Cincinnati.
Well, you talk about that defense of Cincinnati. That was only the 52nd offensive play by Pitt. But for two long pass plays, this Cincinnati defense has controlled the game.
First and 10 at the 18. Now well inside field goal range, as Cincinnati will certainly be looking for more. Brutza. Looking towards the end zone, wide open is Goodman. A blown coverage by Pitt. And just too much under the air under the ball for Grootsa. You think he realizes it?
Oh, all he had to do was basically throw a punt out there. Pitt was playing a two-deep coverage, and there were two receivers way outside to the right of the screen. Nobody covered the inside receiver. He just ran into the end zone, and Grootsa could have waited and just thrown a punt to him.
Second down and 10. Pitt rushes only four. Grootsa escapes the pressure. Fires and has a man. Very close to a first down if it's ruled a catch, but they ruled it an incompletion. Blades once again is down out of bounds, and it looks as if he is cramping once again.
But once you get the cramps, they will not go away that evening. They will keep coming back. Well, that ball was bobbled along the sidelines, according to the official.
Well, Butler Benton, the intended receiver, appeared to have control. Let's take another look. I think that's a catch. I thought he had don't you think he had possession and it came out after he was knocked out of bounds?
The rule is that the ground cannot cause a fumble, but it can cause an incompletion. And if you catch the ball going out of bounds as you're falling down, even if you hit the ground and then the ball comes out, it's incomplete because you must complete the process and get up with that football.
You must return to the ground with possession.
That means that's only the rule on the out-of-bounds play, correct?
Actually, that's the rule on any catch.
Yeah, you have to return to the ground with possession.
3:49 to go.
The ruling on the prior play is under review.
Well, by definition, it's certainly an incompletion. And I'm not even sure why, by definition, this would need to be reviewed if the ball popped out just as he hit the ground.
Well, he's checking to see, did he actually come down inbounds with the ball? Come back down. Is he back down? He's back down now. And does he have possession now?
He was down with 2 feet inbounds and had the ball, but now when he hits the ground, the ball pops out.
But he's come down inbounds with possession on the ball, with the ball. He's returned to ground with possession.
Now here's what I think they'll see, though, Rod. We'll see how this goes. I think what they'll see is he is hit by the defender with his feet still in the air. So he's in the process of falling down without making a football move, which is to say make a step or something like that. And when he hits the ground, when the ball comes out, I think they'll rule it incomplete.
Well, he doesn't have to make
After
a football
review,
move.
The ruling on the field is confirmed. The pass is incomplete. Third down.
So it will be third down and 10 as Benton is not credited with a catch. Obviously two down territory. Well, actually not. I take that back. Not two down territory for Cincinnati because you can kick the field goal and then try the onside kick. Down eight.
You need two scores. It doesn't matter in which order you get them.
Selleck has been quiet, but he comes up with a catch, and it looks to be good enough for a first down here. Stopping the clock right at the sticks. This may require a measurement.
Well, they need to hurry and get to the line of scrimmage.
Rob Similcare, let's check in with you.
Ace B Blades, it's just cramp problems here. The first time we saw him go out of the game in that last defensive series, it was his left calf muscle cramping up. On that last play on this near sideline, it was his right calf muscle cramping up. So he is hurting on both sides right now, and right now he's over on that Pitt sideline trying to get that worked out.
Rob, thanks very much. That means that in this most crucial of situations, as it looks as if Cincinnati has the first down by the nose of the football, and they do. But right now, the Pitt Panthers have one of their two best defensive players out of the game. They still have Darrell Revis on the field, but HB Blades trying to work out cramps on the sideline. So Scott McKillopin
is under review.
And now they will review what I would assume is the spot of the football.
Is there a such thing as too much review?
If there is, we're experiencing it right now.
Well, it certainly does break the momentum for a team.
Right now, Cincinnati does have momentum. Grootsa has been managing this game so well and he's been doing it with a lot of personal courage. He's been juking tacklers. He's been taking hits. And here we see Celek. Let's see where his knee is down when the ball hits. There. No, that's going to be short.
And just for your edification here, this is a judgment call. A judgment as to where you place the ball, and it is a reviewable call. That's a judgment. Right?
It's not a judgment,
though.
It is
a judgment.
No, it's where the football is when his knee's down. That's a black and white call.
It's a judgment.
No, the judgment was on where the ball should have been placed in the first place. What is black and white is where the ball should actually be placed. This is the equivalent of a ball breaking the plane. Where is the football when his knee hits the ground?
Okay, I'm convinced.
And I think, Trevor, you're right. They're going to back the football up a yard.
I am so staying out of this.
Hey, you persuaded me.
But you know what? Cincinnati now is in great position. Because now, as long as they don't turn it over, they're going to get one of the two scores that they need, either a touchdown or a field goal, and they'll be in position to try another onside kick. I mean, Cincinnati.
After review, there is indisputable video evidence that when the runner's knee hit, the ball was at the 9-yard line. The ball will be placed at the 9-yard line. It will be fourth down.
Now it's fourth down and one, guys. You need a touchdown and you need a field goal. Do you go for it here, or do you send your field goal unit out and try and get the three on fourth and one?
I say you kick it, and then you go again. You kick it, you need two scores.
And they're going to go for it on fourth and one.
I agree with you, Rod.
You need two.
So here's a first guess if Cincinnati fails to convert. Fourth down and a yard. Again, the ball will be placed ready for play, and the clock will start.
Yeah, game over if you don't make this. If you kick the field goal, you extend the game.
Quarterback sneak, and it will be close. Forward progress for Grootsa got him right to the 8-yard line, and that's where he needed to get for a first down. It will have to require a measurement, though, once again, you'd think.
Well, you know, the rationale, I think they should have kicked it, but yep. The rationale for going for it is they might not get this close to the end zone on their next drive, and so maybe they say this is our best shot.
That's not a convincing argument to me, because you need to keep the game going. If you don't make it here, game is over. You kick the field goal, you still have a chance.
It comes down to this measurement.
Game's over.
They didn't get it.
There you go. Game over. That's why you kick the field goal.
So the first guess proves true.
He said he wants a review of that spot.
Yeah, he wants a challenge. He wants to use his challenge. Antonio wants to challenge it right now. That's what he's calling it for.
Cincinnati is challenging the spot on the prior play.
I thought they got it.
You say it's going to be. I don't know how the hell you.
Well, let's see if we get indisputable video evidence. And I'm not sure at a pileup like that how indisputable the video evidence could be.
This presents a little different kind of a issue. How do you determine where you spot the ball when it's not a factor of where the knee goes down?
I guess you just have to determine where forward progress was stopped.
And that would be kind of a judgment call.
Well, right? You be the judge.
Okay.
No, he got that.
I think that's a good call. I mean, there was not much movement at all.
Well, in these replays, you can't even see the football inside that pile, so I don't know how you make any type of a judgment.
Well, I think you're right. You can't have any evidence that would show you enough to overturn the call.
In order to spot the football, at some point, you have to be able to see it. And we don't have any video that shows even where the football is.
I mean, there's nothing they can do with that.
You'd really have to have a sternum cam to see that, because everybody piled in there and any external view was blocked.
But, you know, again, the point is you kick the field goal and keep the game alive.
That's the larger point to be made here, that if you kick the field goal, then you're back in a position where you can onside kick or maybe even kick it deep. Who knows, with 3:35 to go, use your timeouts. And Cincinnati has two left. And maybe position yourself, as you said, to extend the game.
Yeah, Cincinnati gambled, and they lost with it. If you take the sure three, you at least have a shot.
Yeah.
After review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. It will be Pittsburgh's ball, first and 10. Cincinnati has charged a timeout. That is their final timeout of the half.
I'm wondering how the decision on the field can be confirmed. To me, that's just a situation, not where there's confirmation or a change to be made. That there's just no way you can make any type of determination, right? You can't see the football.
Yeah, but that's the way the instant replay rule works. In order to overturn the call on the field, you have to have indisputable video evidence.
Right.
And you don't have it there, so the call on the field stays.
First and 10 for Pitt. A five-play drive that resulted in three video reviews and one challenge by Mark D'Antonio. And after all is said and done, the fumble by Palko on the exchange with Shane Brooks does not hurt Pitt. They have it back with a chance to run out the clock. Brooks to the 11 for a gain of three. Again, right after we're done here in Cincinnati, Floyd Mayweather is the guest tonight of Stephen A. Smith. Quite frankly, with Stephen A. Coming up next here on ESPN2.
Well, with Louisville and West Virginia doing very well in the Big East, if Pitt were to really come on, don't you think that the perception of the Big East would be much better, much greater in college football?
That's
a tougher conference.
Absolutely. We'll give them three teams in the top tier.
To the outside, Brooks cuts it back, and he's very close to a first down.
And Trevor, I think part of the reason for that is because of Pitt's history and tradition as being a great football school in the past, which is what Wanstead is trying to bring it back to be. And if he has the ability to do that, I think Pitt becoming a top team in the Big East changes the perception of the Big East when you add it with Louisville and West Virginia.
And Cincinnati, after tonight is complete, their schedule only gets more difficult. First and 10 now for Pitt with 2.5 minutes to play. Brooks brought down by Nakamura. But let's take a look at what is to come for Cincinnati. And boy, is this a difficult stretch.
Well, at Ohio State, at Virginia Tech, they'll pick up some nice paychecks there, but that's going to really get beaten down. Miami of Ohio is always a big rivalry with Cincinnati. And then at Louisville, holy smokes.
Not only tough games, but tough games on the road. Second and 7. Brooks, a gain of about 5 more. I think Ohio State plays this weekend, by the way.
Yeah, weekend's not over, huh? It's not over. Just getting started. That's a good win tomorrow night. I assume, Trevor, you'll be watching.
I'll be watching. I think it's tight, but I'll go with Ohio State in this one.
Again, we will have it for you. Saturday night, college football, ESPN on ABC, number 1 and number 2, Ohio State and Texas. 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific, presented by Southwest Airlines. It's also available in high def. 3rd and 2. And if Pitt picks up the first down here, they could simply kneel on the football. It goes to the up back, Conridge Collins, and he is a yard shy.
Well, Rod, you're doing analysis of that game for ESPN.com. Care to make a prediction?
Oh, I usually don't predict in games in which I'm working, but this is such a big game. I think I will go ahead and tell you I'm leaning towards Texas. I'll pick Texas because of their defense and the fact that they're the defending national champs playing at home.
Well, they play with the kind of fire that Wanstead just showed. They'll be all right.
It's really a toss-up game.
I'm interested to see Lima Swede against Micah Jenkins or Malcolm Jenkins.
Nice punt by Grassel under some pressure. Stewart to the 43 with 19 seconds to go. So Pitt is about to improve to 2-0 on the season. They will be 6-0 all time against Cincinnati. Mark D'Antonio built this game up as being extremely important to his program and on the sports landscape here in Cincinnati. And he will obviously be disappointed in the loss. As now the Big Ben set up for the Bearcats. Brusa launches one and it's intercepted. Revis down the sideline. He returned one for a touchdown last week against Virginia, and he does it again tonight against Cincinnati. Darrell Revis goes the distance, and that's some salt in the wound for the Bearcats, and maybe a cherry on top for Revis after he fumbled two punts tonight.
Well, Grutza has played a heroic game tonight. Under pressure, I think he might have won that quarterback job. We talked about the two quarterback system, and I think that Nick Davila is an excellent player. But just the way Grutza managed the game, even with that last play trying to make something happen, I think he can be proud of his performance.
Connor Lee's extra point is good. 33-15 Pitt on top. Disappointment certainly for Cincinnati. But the Bearcats had a never-say-die attitude tonight. There were several times where it seemed like this game was over. Pitt certainly some self-inflicted wounds, but Cincinnati never stopped playing.
No, but the difference with Pitt, again, is the fact that they are making big plays, game-changing plays. Pick six. They had two of them last week. Tonight, touchdown passes. Long distances. They had that last week. Again, Pitt could not do that last year. It's an impressive to see how quickly they've addressed their speed issue and turned that around.
And, Rod, when you look at those big plays you're talking about, three big plays, interception for a touchdown we just saw, and two long pass plays, those three plays out of this whole entire game, 3 hours plus, over 100 offensive plays between these teams, three plays made the difference in winning and losing.
Well, Tyler Palko's thrown for 267 yards on 11 completions. Yeah. That is the definition of a big play night.
Well, I mean, that's what you're getting in college football now. You get big plays on offense and big plays on defense, including negative plays, sacks, tackles for losses. That's the name of the game.
Again, the new rule in college football this year is the clock starts the moment the kicker's foot hits the football. So this will be the final play tonight. And it is squibbed down to Stewart. Not much there. And that will do it. 33-15 is your final. Pitt over Cincinnati. So Pitt starts off the season 2-0 and 1-0 in the Big East. That's all from Cincinnati. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. Now here's Quite Frankly with Stephen A. Smith.
It's my first